Good morning and welcome to the fourth meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2024. The first and only item on our agenda this morning is consideration of the Children, Care and Justice Scotland Bill at Stage 2, Day 2. Last week the committee considered amendments and agreed up to and including Section 11 of the Bill. We will therefore begin our consideration today from Section 12 of the Bill. And I would like to welcome the Minister for Children, Young People and Keeping the Promise to the meeting and her supporting officials. I note again that the officials seated at the table are not here to support them, are here to support the Minister, sorry, get it right, but not able to speak in the debates on amendments. The members should therefore direct their comments or questions for the Scottish Government to the Minister. Before we begin, I will explain again the procedure we will be following this morning for anyone who is watching. The amendments have been lodged on the bill have all been grouped together. There will be one debate on each group of amendments, and I'll call the member who lodged the first amendment in that group to speak to and move that amendment and to speak to all other amendments in that group. I will then call any other members who have lodged amendments in that group. Members who have not lodged amendments in the group but who wish to speak should catch my attention. And if she has not already spoken on the group, I will then invite the Minister to contribute to the debate. The debate on the group will be concluded by me inviting the member who moved the first amendment in the group to wind up. And following the debate on each group, I will check whether the member who moved the first amendment in the group wishes to press it to a vote or to withdraw it. If they wish to press ahead, I will put the question on that amendment. If a member wishes to withdraw their amendment after it has been moved, they must seek the agreement of other members to do so. If any member present objects, the committee immediately moves to the vote on the amendment. If any member does not want to move their amendment when called, they should say, "Not moved." Please note that any other member present may move such an amendment. If no one moves the amendment, I will immediately call the next amendment on the marshalled list. As a reminder, only committee members are allowed to vote, and voting in any division is by a show of hands. It's important that members keep their hands raised clearly until the clerks have recorded the vote. The committee is required to indicate formally that it has considered and agreed each section of the bill, and so I will also put a question on each section at the appropriate point. And now that we have covered the housekeeping matters, we can restart the substantive business. Okay, I'll just grab a quick drink. And we're going to start on Section 12, Reporting Restrictions, Self-Identification. And I'm going to call Amendment 20 in the name of the Minister, group with Amendments 24, 48, 49 and 50. Minister, to move Amendment 20 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, everyone. As introduced, Sections 12 and 13 of the Bill place restrictions on the reporting of certain information which could identify a person in relation to an offence or suspected offence which occurred whilst they were children, whether they were a suspect, victim or witness in relation to that offence. The restrictions apply respectively before, during or after any court proceedings in respect of the offence. Before introduction, the Bill did not make provision to allow those persons to self-identify by publishing information covered by the reporting restrictions without committing offence, unless a court had dispensed with those restrictions or they had otherwise come to an end. So this could potentially criminalise a person for publishing their own information. This approach was criticised by stakeholders at Stage 1, including the Campaign for Complainer Anonymity and the Children and Young People's Commissioner Scotland. And we accept this did not necessarily strike the correct balance of children's rights to freedom of expression, autonomy and control over their own information and experiences, with their rights to privacy and protection of other rights in the context of a child's evolving capabilities and development. These amendments, therefore, make provision to enable a person to self-identify through publishing information which is otherwise subject to a reporting restriction without committing a criminal offence. Amendment 24 enables a child victim or witness to self-identify prior to any court proceedings for the alleged offence where a court has not already dispensed with reporting restrictions. Once court proceedings have been raised, Amendment 48, which inserts a new section 47(1)(bb) into the Criminal Procedure Scotland Act 1995, also enables a child victim or witness to self-publish information that can identify them at any stage of proceedings without seeking the prior authority of the court to do so. Now, this echoes the provisions made in the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Bill in relation to victims of certain offences listed in that bill. For those suspected, accused or convicted of committing an offence in childhood, the considerations are particularly nuanced, resulting in provisions which are slightly different in scope. Now, before any court proceedings, those persons will therefore only be able to self-identify with the consent of the court, as already provided for in Section 12 of the Bill. This is in recognition of the different risks involved for child suspects, including of self-incrimination during an ongoing police investigation. Moreover, once court proceedings have been raised, as provided for in Amendment 48, which inserts a new section 47(1)(bA) into the 1995 Act, those persons will only be able to self-identify on the disposal of proceedings. And this is to align with other provisions in the Bill and seeks to prevent other risks arising, including the right to a fair trial, whether that's of the accused or of other persons. Amendments 49 and 50 are consequential to Amendment 48. We consider that these provisions strike a more appropriate balance, and I would move Amendment 20 and ask the committee to support the other amendments in this group.
Thank you, Minister. I'm looking for any contributions. No, Minister? Ben. Oh, sorry. Apologies. Ben McPherson.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister. I just want to emphasise the welcoming of these amendments and particularly 24 and 48. These matters that you have just set out were, of course, discussed during the Stage 1 process and within the Stage 1 report of the committee, having been raised by stakeholders, including Glasgow Caledonian University. I will certainly be supporting these amendments. However, I also draw attention to Glasgow University's submission to the committee of the 19th of January, which, if the government has not received a copy, the committee can, of course, share that and just ask the government to reflect on that submission prior to Stage 3 to consider if further refinement of these amendments may be of benefit to the issues at hand.
Thank you. Minister?
Thank Mr. McPherson for that contribution. I don't believe I've been cited on that as yet, but that's certainly something that I will look at and consider ahead of Stage 3, but appreciate the comments around the support for the amendments in front of you.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 20 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes,
yes, we are agreed. That means Amendment 20 is agreed to. Thank you. Reporting restrictions, we're moving to now powers and public interest test. And I call Amendment 21, again in the name of the Minister, group with amendments as shown in the grouping. And I remind members of the preemptions in the group. Minister, to move Amendment 21 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Again, thank you, Convener. Now, this group contains a very large number of amendments covering a wide range of important areas, some of which are quite technical amendments, so I require to speak to each of them in turn. Now, first of all, there are a number of government amendments which concern dispensing with reporting restrictions, and these follow on from the amendments that we've just debated concerning a person's right to self-identify through publishing information which is otherwise subject to a reporting restriction without committing a criminal offence. Amendment 42 is my main amendment on this topic, and it would insert a new section 106(bA) into the Criminal Justice Scotland Act 2016 to enable an application dispensing with reporting restrictions to be made in relation to the publication of information relating to a child victim or witness to a suspected offence where no court proceedings are already underway in respect of the offence. And this reflects provisions again in the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Scotland Bill in relation to victims of the offences to which that bill applies. It would essentially enable a person other than a child victim or witness to whom information subject to a reporting restriction relates to apply to the court for an order to dispense with the restriction in order to be able to publish that information. The granting of any dispensation order would, however, be subject to important safeguards. It would require the court to have regard to the best interests of the child as a primary consideration and to consider any relevant representations made by or on behalf of the child or by anyone considered to have an interest in the application. Moreover, the court would also require to be satisfied that the child has understood and appreciates the effect of any dispensation and has given consent to the publication of the information, and that there is no good reason why such an order should not be made. So, subject to those safeguards, it would enable a child victim or witness to consent to a third party publishing the information rather than the child self-identifying through publishing their own information. Other amendments? Amendments.
An intervention just in relation to this section.
So, convener, today this is quite a lengthy sort of group of amendments. I will take the intervention, however, I may respond to all the
Can
amendments.
Can I respond to that? To Mr. Whitfield, you are speaking in the next grouping in this debate, so perhaps you can reference your comments. Just to try and keep the time out, a bit of pace going.
I'm fine with that.
So, other amendments, amendments 32, 41, make changes to section 106B of the 2016 Act in consequence of new section 106BA, so that section 106B will now apply only to dispensing with reporting restrictions in relation to child suspects. The section 106B power remains different in scope from the new section 106BA power. Just as with the provisions on self-identification, there are different considerations in play in relation to child suspects, given the potential adverse impact on future police investigations and, beyond that, fair trial rights. But it would remain possible for a suspect, constable, prosecutor or a media representative to apply for a dispensation from reporting restrictions and for the court to grant that if satisfied that it was in the interests of justice. However, Mr. Whitfield's Amendment 191 would propose the wholesale removal of Section 106B, and this would mean that there would be no scope at all for reporting restrictions to be dispensed with prior to any court proceedings, whether in relation to a child victim, witness or suspect. Now, whilst I can appreciate Mr. Whitfield might not believe a media representative should be able to apply to the court to have such reporting restrictions lifted, by removing this section entirely, a constable or prosecutor would be breaking the law by publishing any identifiable information in relation to a child suspect. Police Scotland and COPFS have been clear they require the ability to do so in some form. Publication of such information could be crucial for the protection of that child or other people and could seriously interfere with the ability of these organisations to investigate crimes and prosecute. And this would be to the detriment of everyone involved and could interfere with the ability to protect the public and children. Moreover, even in the case of a media representative, it can also be legitimate for the court to consider whether reporting restrictions can be lifted where satisfied that this is in the interests of justice. I would therefore urge Mr. Whitfield not to press this amendment, and if he does, that committee members do not support this. Turning back to my own amendments, Amendment 60 would insert new sections 47ZA and 47ZB into the Criminal Procedure Scotland Act 1995 to make provision enabling applications to the court to dispense with reporting restrictions in relation to the publication of information respectively in relation to a child accused after the disposal of any court proceedings and in relation to a child victim or witness during or after the completion of court proceedings. Amendments 44 and 45 are consequential on that. This broadly ensures parity in terms of the provisions in relation to dispensing with reporting restrictions, whether prior to or during or after any subsequent court proceedings. I will now turn to Ruth Maguire's amendments 137 and 138 concerning respectively the court's powers to remove or reinstate reporting restrictions. Now, before I come on to those amendments specifically, I would like to begin by stating that I absolutely do recognise the intention behind these amendments and her other amendments to be debated in a later group, in terms of seeking to reduce the trauma experienced by those who lose a child as a result of crime. I understand Ms Maguire's motivation for lodging them, and I would also like to acknowledge the letter sent to me and a number of other ministers from families bereaved by a crime calling for change in this area. This was followed by a similar letter from a number of organisations. The Government is absolutely committed to considering this issue in more detail and in discussion with those with lived experience, victim support organisations, academics, legal professionals and media representatives. Towards this end, the Justice Secretary provided further international evidence to this committee and the Criminal Justice Committee in a paper of the 23rd of January, which I think it's important that we reflect on. The Scottish Government are also hosting a roundtable event with victims' organisations and a range of partners in February to discuss experiences and options. The Cabinet Secretary and I are committed to working with Ms Maguire and other members on this matter, but we need to take the necessary time to do so. In respect of both amendments 137 and 138 at this stage and as drafted, I do have significant concerns about how these could work in practice. I would note that officials in the criminal justice agencies have raised concerns with my officials as to whether the amendments would be enforceable in their current form. In the case of Amendment 137 and an order under new Section 106C, vast resources would be required to identify all publications breaching the order and ensure that they were removed or withdrawn from public availability. And such is the media landscape that publications, publishers and broadcasters may well be located out with the UK, and so publications might have reached an international audience. There are also questions around the value of such provisions, given that once there is widespread knowledge of an individual's identity, it is impossible to completely retract that information. Today's media landscape is almost unrecognisable from when legislation on reporting restrictions was first introduced. It's no longer limited to the traditional print and broadcast channels, but ranges from international news agencies down to individuals posting on public forums, with an exceptional growth in the number of self-published authors, bloggers and influencers. This has been reflected in the updated definition of publication in this bill. Many of those out with the larger media organisations do not have ready access to legal teams to advise them on what can and cannot be published. It is essential, therefore, that as far as possible, provisions on anonymity are unambiguous and offer legal certainty, a sentiment that has been echoed by academics from the Campaign for Complainer Anonymity at Glasgow Caledonian University. The ability for the restrictions to be applied retrospectively, to be varied or revoked in relation to particular information, people or publications, and to be reinstated at any time following expiry, could lead to considerable confusion and risk, criminalising those who are unaware of or unable to follow repeated court orders varying, revoking or reinstating restrictions. We need to ensure that we balance our desire for appropriate safeguards and protection with the principles of open justice and freedom of expression. Although the powers of removal, of course, rest with the courts, who would need to take decisions in an ECHR-compliant way, it might be difficult, if not impossible, for a court to be able to exercise those powers in a rights-compatible way in order to identify relevant published information that should be removed or reinstated, or to identify who would be responsible for that. Of course, once information has been published in the breach of any restrictions, the person originally responsible would have no control of how that information might then have been used or disseminated by others. In summary, there are a host of legal complexities here which require further consideration and consultation as to how measures would realistically work in practice. Ruth Maguire's Amendment 138 provides a further power to reinstate reporting restrictions following their removal and raises similar concerns to Amendment 137 in terms of its workability and enforceability, and with the potential to undermine legal certainty. For the reasons outlined, I am unable to support Amendments 137 and 138 and would urge Ruth Maguire not to praise them. I am, however, fully committed to further discussion and engagement on how we better protect the privacy of those bereaved by crime, which the committee will come on to discuss shortly. The next group of amendments concern the removal of the power of Scottish ministers to dispense with reporting restrictions. The government's amendment 51 would mean that the Scottish ministers would no longer have the power to dispense with reporting restrictions after the completion of court proceedings. Consequently, only a court would have such a power under section 47(3) of the Criminal Procedure Scotland Act 1995 to dispense with reporting restrictions on disposal of the proceedings. This change will locate such decision-making solely with the courts. This amendment follows the compelling stakeholder evidence, including from the Campaign for Complainer Anonymity, who stated, "We believe the courts are the only appropriate forum for making decisions on whether reporting restrictions in cases involving children continue to apply or are set aside." In practice, as it stands, the ministerial power is partial in that ministers can only dispense reporting restrictions after the completion of court proceedings, and that would only be before the child turned 18, when restrictions at present automatically lapse. So going forward, it is likely decisions about dispensing with reporting restrictions and or extending restrictions beyond the child turning 18 will be made at the completion or disposal of proceedings. If the restrictions are extended beyond a child turning 18, there are provisions to enable the order to be reviewed or revoked. Leaving decision-making with the court brings a number of advantages. Judicial decision-making can benefit from hearing the full evidence in a case with inbuilt appeal provisions in a way the ministerial power could not. And this is particularly important given the huge implications and potential risk for the child involved if reporting restrictions are dispensed with, including in respect of children's rights. This change would also afford consistency with the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Scotland Bill, introduced in April 23, where ministers have no power to dispense with reporting restrictions for cases covered by that bill. Amendments 61, 68, 69, 72, 76 and 81 are all consequential to Amendment 51. Government Amendment 62 concerns the right of appeal under Section 47A of the 95 Act. On introduction of the bill, that made provision for a child accused, victim, witness or a prosecutor to appeal the court's decision to dispense with reporting restrictions. Amendment 62 brings greater clarity of the ability for victims and witnesses to appeal this decision. This is an important change to ensure the ability of victims and witnesses to exercise this right is as well understood as possible. Moving now to the amendments concerning the extension of reporting restrictions. The bill on introduction did not allow reporting restrictions for victims and witnesses to extend beyond 18 or the conclusion of proceedings if that came later. This was to enable victims and witnesses in adulthood to be able to self-identify should they wish to do so. However, as we've already debated in the previous group, the proposed amendments would enable child victims and witnesses to self-identify at any point in time without breaching reporting restrictions. However, various stakeholders, including the Campaign for Complainer Anonymity, Together Scotland and the Children and Young People's Commissioner, criticised the fact that whilst the bill at introduction enabled a child accused to seek an extension of reporting restrictions, no similar provision was made in respect of child victims and witnesses. This is therefore addressed by Government Amendment 65, which amends the power in Section 47B of the 95 Act to extend reporting restrictions in relation to child victims and witnesses. Amendments 66 and 67 are consequential to that. Moreover, Government Amendments 54 and 55 would also enable child victims or witnesses to appeal any decision to extend or not extend reporting restrictions in the same way as a child accused. These amendments now ensure parity between a child accused and between a child victim or witness in relation to decision-making around extension of reporting restrictions. On Ruth Maguire's amendments 147, 148, 149, 150 and 192, I again understand the intention behind these and associated amendments and the motivation for lodging them. Those too make provision for the extension of reporting restrictions with associated rights of appeal. These amendments appear to have a similar intent to the government amendments that I've just described. However, the government's amendments do go further in some respects, as they also extend to child witnesses as well as victims. And I'm concerned that Ms Maguire's amendments would not extend to child witnesses. I strongly believe that child victims and witnesses should have the option to apply to have reporting restrictions extended, in keeping with our person-centred, trauma-informed approach. To limit this to victims would mean that child witnesses could miss out on these important protections and benefits into adulthood. So, whilst I acknowledge that Ms Maguire's Amendment 148 would also enable extensions of reporting restrictions in relation to deceased victims, I have concerns about the extension through this bill of provisions in relation to deceased victims and the potential adverse consequences of that. And I'll address my concerns when we come to debate this shortly. If an extension is granted at the request of one family member, should another family member want to identify the deceased child publicly, they would have to apply to the court to have this order varied or revoked, with the emotional and the financial costs involved. Failure to do so could result in that individual and anyone else who subsequently published that information being criminalised, adding to the trauma of both that individual and their loved ones. There could be different views between family members, and it's unclear what would happen in these situations. Another concern is that extending the protection to deceased victims could inevitably extend the protection to those who commit offences. And we must keep in mind that tragically the majority of child homicide victims are killed by a parent. It's hard to understand how you could identify one without leading to the identification of the other. I'm therefore unable to support Ruth Maguire's amendments for the reasons outlined. And again, I would urge her not to press them in return for a commitment from the government for further discussion and engagement on this deeply important issue, allowing time for the level of detailed consultation and consideration that we've committed to and which I know Ruth Maguire is keen to participate in. As I said previously, the government is keen to seek a solution to the issues raised by bereaved families and victim support organisations and to engage on those issues in an open-minded way. But it's essential that we fully explore the complexities involved to avoid any unintended consequences for making such a significant and expedited change to the law. I note this issue has potential implications too for the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Scotland Bill, which also includes provisions about reporting restrictions for the protection of other victims of offences under that bill. Instead, I would ask members to support the government amendments concerning the extension of reporting restrictions. I firmly believe that the government amendments are more consistent with our trauma-informed approach and provide equality for both child victims and witnesses and accused, and also bring greater consistency with provisions under the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Bill. Finally, I would like to address the government's amendments concerning the application of the public interest test, which should inform decision-making by the courts in relation to dispensing with reporting restrictions or not. In further support of Scotland's incorporation of UNCRC, these amendments vary the tests to be considered in making decisions regarding reporting restrictions. Amendments 70, 71, 73, 74, 75, 77, 78, 79 and 82 make further amendments to Section 47D of the 95 Act, which make provisions for the court's application of the public interest test in relation to decision-making around dispensing with or extending reporting restrictions. In relation to decisions concerning a child accused, Amendment 73 ensures that their best interests must be regarded as a primary consideration. Amendments 75 and 79 concern decisions in relation to a child victim or witness. Amendment 79 in particular would likewise mean that where a child victim or witnesses is under 18, the court should regard the best interests of the child as a primary consideration and should have no regard to the length of time until the person will reach the age of 18. This is because reporting restrictions might not cease when a child turns 18, as we've debated it already. This brings consistency with provisions for child accused and should address the concerns raised by stakeholders about having differential provisions in relation to consideration of these matters, dependent on whether they relate to a child accused or a child victim or witness. Moreover, these amendments reflect the call from stakeholders during Stage 1 that the best interest test was more consistent with the language in UNCRC. You'll be pleased to know that that concludes my discussion of the amendments in this group. I move Amendment 21 and urge Martin Whitfield not to press his amendment. I likewise urge Ruth Maguire not to press the amendments pending further exploration of the important matters these and her other amendments raise. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. Indeed, there was a lot in that grouping. So, but can I now call Martin Whitfield to speak to his Amendment 191 and the other amendments in the group? Thank you.
I'm very grateful, Convener, and good morning to all. I speak to the simple one-line Amendment 191, which effectively removes a section for which the government in its own amendments are proposing a different section, and I'll come to that in a moment. But the reason behind the amendment that is in my name follows on from the UN Committee on the Rights of Their Child and the General Comment 24 that they made. And I would like to put this onto the record to quote, "There should be lifelong protection from publication regarding crimes committed by children. The rationale for the non-publication rule and for its continuation after the child reaches the age of 18 is that publication causes ongoing stigmatisation, which is likely to have a negative impact on access to education, work, housing, or safety. This impedes the child's reintegration and assumption of a constructive role in society. States parties should thus ensure that the general rule is lifelong privacy protection pertaining to all types of media, including social media." And I can go really no further than that in respect of the amendment that I've brought, but I would like to take the opportunity to explore the invite from the government to withdraw my amendment because of their proposed section 106BA. And I have a number of questions for the Minister, which I hope she can satisfy me with, which will lead me not to press my amendment. The first is in relation to subsection 2 regarding the sheriff making the order on an application of a person other than the child who wishes to publish information relating to the child and whether or not the government envisages any boundaries with regard to whom that person may be. And also with regard, I don't know whether would it be easier for the Minister if I go through my questions and then... okay. Subsection 3, which is possibly the start of the most crucial section in regards of my questions. So this power rests with the sheriff, and it gives persons an opportunity to make representations. So that's more than a simple application, but to make applications. The person who made the application, the child to whom the information relates, and any other person the sheriff considers to have an interest in the application. Given that the public interest test and the best interest test overlies the decision that the sheriff, or overlies the environment in which the sheriff has to make this decision, are you looking at an objective or a subjective assessment by the sheriff which would need to be justified? Also in subsection 4, it makes reference to conditions, particularly 4A2, uses the phrase appreciates what the effect of making such an order would be. Again, I would inquire as to the extent that the sheriff has the power to investigate and what resources will be made available to the sheriff to investigate the appreciation level of the young person. Is the government expecting the current tests on the ability of a child to make a decision to be those that will be used in the phrase appreciates? Or, under the best interest test, does it extend beyond that to look for objective evidence that the child, that the young person appreciates? I also have a certain questions about, the Minister rightly pointed out, to the growing media landscape, and the fact that once things are out, they are out, and getting them back in is impossible in reality. And the Minister also spoke about the international effect of the current media baseload that we have. And I would ask the Minister to confirm that full consideration has been made of the amendments that the government are proposing in relation to the fact that at the end of the day, so many of these cases will revolve around families, very small communities, extended families, and she's spoken at length about the protections, but I would ask her to put on record that this has been, that has been fully considered, subject to the amendments that I understand may come at stage three with regard to some of the other amendments that we have. And also, I'd just like to put on record, it's very difficult to rest on a basis where you're relying on the court to make a decision, convener, and that you are allowing the opportunity for people to go to court in some of the amendments that the government have proposed, in particular to remove any ministerial or governmental role in decision making, but then also to say with other amendments that there is a financial cost of going to court, because some of the people that I think will be envisaging trying to overturn an order, seek an order, or seek an amendment to order are people who will find themselves in very financial, precarious positions, and they may not therefore have the avenue that the government has proposed as a way out of these problems. So I'll leave it at that point, convener. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Whitfield. Minister, perhaps you can address those when you're winding up. Is that okay? Perfect. Thank you. Can I now call Ruth Maguire to speak to Amendment 137 and other amendments in the group? Thank you.
Thank you, convener. I will make more substantive remarks in the next section, with your permission. I think at the moment what I would just want to say is that the focus of this bill is children and the rights of children. Children can, of course, cause harm, be victims of criminal harm directly or as a result of a sibling or family member being harmed. All of these children matter. All of these children, no matter what they're experiencing that's led them to come into contact with the care or justice system, they should be equally entitled to their rights. I would acknowledge that balancing rights is not straightforward, and I hear all the reasons to not take action, but it can't be beyond us to uphold and promote the rights of all children, and this mustn't be put in the too difficult box because of the challenges around bringing a solution to what is most definitely a problem that causes trauma and stress to families and siblings. And that's all I want to say just now.
Thank you. Minister, I call on yourself to wind up now, please.
Thank you, convener. I will try to get through all Mr. Whitfield's points. So in relation to... bear with me. Your first point around allowing people to apply for that section is very important to enable the police and the as I outlined in my opening comments, it's extremely important to allow the police and the prosecutor to publish when that would be required. Subsection 2 is left open so that others can apply, and this is not restricted. And I would say that the sheriff would look at matters objectively, weighing up all the different factors. Obviously, this would be on a case-by-case basis, and it would be for the sheriff to make the decisions based on each case individually. It would be for the sheriff to consider how best to consider the views of the child, depending on the circumstances of the specific case and the age of the child. The opportunity to make representation is again wide and will be for the court to decide who has an interest based on the specifics of the case. And I would say that the court involvement should minimise any risks of the child being or being perceived to be coerced into consenting to a third party publishing identifiable information about a child. So it really is about safeguarding the child in that respect. As I say, I am more than happy to have further discussion with Mr. Whitfield around some of the more specifics he was looking for, but I believe that the government amendments provide the appropriate, what is required, as well as the appropriate protections for children and young people, and I would urge Mr. Whitfield to support the government amendments.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 21 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes, we are. No, we are not agreed. Apologies, Pam Duncan Clancy. There will be a division. Those in favour? Those against? And abstain? Those abstaining? Thank you. Okay. The result of the vote on Amendment 21 is 4-9, against none, and abstaining 1. Amendment 21 is therefore agreed. Thank you. We're now moving on to the grouping reporting restrictions and time restrictions taking effect. And I call Amendment 22 in the name of the Minister, group with Amendment 46. Minister, to move Amendment 22 and speak to both amendments in the group, please.
Thank you, Convener. So these amendments would mean reporting restrictions will now apply from the point of a child aged under 18 becomes a victim of or a witness to a suspected offence and continue to apply even where the victim or witness has subsequently turned 18 until the disposal of any criminal proceedings. This will provide parity with provisions for child suspects and accused and avoid a situation where a child suspect or accused and a child victim or witness both turn 18 prior to the commencement of proceedings but do not both have the protection of reporting restrictions remaining in place, including in the event of subsequent court proceedings. This change brings greater parity of protection and addresses the concerns raised by stakeholders, particularly victim support organisations. The bill had been framed this way at introduction to enable childhood victims and witnesses to be able to self-identify in adulthood. However, following amendments 20, 24, 48, 49 and 50 debated in the previous group, and this bill would now allow victims and witnesses of childhood offences to self-identify at any point in proceedings without breaching reporting restrictions. These provisions are more consistent with our trauma-informed, person-centred approach, ensuring that those who are victims or witnesses when aged under 18 have their privacy protected, regardless of the date of publication or if and when criminal proceedings are commenced. I move Amendment 22.
Minister, anything to wind up? No?
Nope. No further comments.
Excellent. So the question is that Amendment 22 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes. We are agreed. Therefore, Amendment 22 is agreed. Thank you. And now we move on to reporting restrictions for deceased victims. And I call Amendment 124 in the name of Ruth Maguire, group with amendments as shown in the grouping, and I would like to remind members of the preemptions in this group. Ruth Maguire, to move Amendment 124 and speak to all amendments in the group, please.
Thank you, Convener. If initially I can just lay out what my amendments intend to do. They can be grouped into four main categories. They intend to extend reporting restrictions that the bill would apply in respect of victims aged under 18 so that they also apply to deceased underage victims. To give the court the same power to extend reporting restrictions in respect of an underage victim, alive or dead, as the bill confers in respect of an underage offender. To provide a mechanism by which offenders, whether suspected, alleged or convicted, live victims or the close family of deceased victims can request an order requiring the takedown of information that would have been covered by a reporting restriction while an offence was suspected or during proceedings. And to provide a mechanism by which offenders, whether suspected, alleged or convicted, victims or the close family of deceased victims can request an order reinstating in whole or part reporting restrictions. And I move the amendments in my name. Folk will have seen the open letter sent from 65 families urging change, but committee member colleagues will remember that it was a letter from an individual family member that first took our attention to this area. It laid out the significant impact continued and traumatising press and social media coverage had on them and asked MSPs to be mindful of the impact of our words and to not name victims when discussing this topic. Since then, Victim Support have led the way in campaigning for change, and I commend them for their work in ensuring that the voice of victims have been heard. I fully understand that this is not a straightforward matter to solve. I understand that in legislation we have to be alert to unintended consequences, and I would also acknowledge that the committee has not taken extensive evidence on this matter. But what I can be absolutely certain of is that there is a need to address this, not just to discuss it further, but to actually address it. The evidence that we do have for change is compelling. A parent who lost their child to murder said, and if I may quote them directly, "When my child died as a result of murder, every detail of their life, their siblings and school was in the public domain. This was put under further microscopic detail during the trial, while the perpetrator was afforded significant privacy and protection. The media intrusion which followed my child's death further compounded the trauma I was already experiencing. My children cannot be children because of the constant fear of what the media will print next. It still goes on to this day, and I am constantly worried when and how my other children will find out more distressing details about their sibling's death." She goes on, I've had several articles and pieces of inaccurate information removed from the mainstream press and social media, but the coverage feels never ending. Every day, I'm constantly reminded about the traumatic nature of my child's death. This could have been prevented had my child's name not automatically been released to the public when they died. I would acknowledge and thank the Minister for her words in terms of further discussion and engagement. And she mentioned the round table, which I think would be hugely important. What will be crucial in that, though, I think, is that the voice of victims are at that table. And I would seek reassurance that those with direct experience of the trauma that this causes to surviving siblings will be part of the discussion. Absolutely.
In terms of the round table, because we appreciate this is an important part of this discussion, would you look for equitability in terms of representation of victims as well as the accused, rather than simply representation?
I think that's a hugely important point. I was going to come on to say that the committee have heard from an academic who gave very helpful specific reasons around the challenges. There was one sentence about the human cost of this. I think that we want the expertise at that table, but we must never forget the people who are affected. Everybody dealing with this topic needs to be looking in the eye of the families who are affected. So I would seek assurance from the Minister on that matter. And I can leave my remarks there for now, Convener.
Thank you. Minister, can I come on yourself to respond? Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. I'd like to begin again by reiterating, as I did in Group 13, that I absolutely recognise the intention behind the amendments in this group in terms of seeking to reduce the trauma experienced by those who lose a child as a result of crime, and again understand Ms Maguire's motivation for lodging them. I reiterate again that the Government is committed to considering this issue in more detail and in discussion with those with lived experience. But yes.
Is the Minister able to confirm my earlier point in terms of equitability between representation from victims' groups and those of the accused at said round table? In other words, I appreciate and agree that the government will clearly give consideration to it, but I just want to flesh out the nature of that consideration, that it will be equitable because of the challenge of balancing rights, which I think my colleague Ruth Maguire alluded to in the earlier grouping.
Thank you. I'm going to address that in just a second. Thank you. Just reiterating the commitment to considering this issue in more detail, and appreciate Ms. Maguire's comments around wanting to see action on this and not just discussion. And I really do believe the steps that the government are taking are leading towards that. In terms of the roundtable, it is focused on deceased victims. As far as I am aware, I believe that victim support organisations will be at that roundtable. However, it's not myself that is organising that. I'm more than happy to seek that information and provide that to the committee in terms of who will be in attendance and who will be contributing. However, I just want to reiterate my comments around the potential for unintended and adverse consequences that could impact negatively on the very people the amendments seek to support, as currently drafted, which is why, as I've said, the government will work very, very closely with Ruth Maguire and other members as we consider these matters fully. So I'll turn first to Amendments 124 to 136, which, taken together, seek to extend reporting restrictions in relation to publication of information which could identify deceased child victims of a crime and their families prior to any court proceedings, so providing a right of anonymity. As I said, I have concerns regarding how certain aspects of these amendments could work in practice. For example, they would require bereaved relatives to go through the emotional and financial cost of applying to a court to be able to publicly identify their deceased child as a victim of crime. It could also risk criminalising, for example, the child's peers who wish to publicly express their grief at the loss of their friend in such terrible circumstances and who may not understand that there are any restrictions.
Just on that point about... Okay. Peers, aunties, social media.
Convener, yes, I've gone against my taking interventions at the end, which I will return to, but I'm happy to take...
I'm going to permit your intervention on this. Okay.
Thank you, Convener. Forgive me for that. I understand the line, that the argument that's being put, but surely if we think about rights and children's rights, we're not suggesting that a cousin or a friend, their right to broadcast their feelings about the deceased is more important than the family of the deceased, not their right to privacy in a family life. It's a challenge.
Absolutely, it's a challenge, and I think that's why I've committed to further discussion on this, because we have to overcome those challenges. It's not about putting importance over one sort of member of a family's over another. It's just about considering how we get this right, I would say. It's essential that we learn from the experience of other comparable jurisdictions who have had to actively amend or repeal legislation on anonymity for deceased victims following changes made at haste and without proper consultation with all those affected. Bereaved families in these jurisdictions, for example, Ireland and Victoria, Australia, have likened such laws to gag clauses and expressed anger at not being able to speak freely about their loved ones. Another concern is the potential for anonymity for deceased child victims to operate as a shield protecting the identity of those who are committing or commit offences. And it's hard to understand, as I said in the previous grouping, how you could identify one at times without leading to the identification of the other. Again, something that needs considered further. It's also unclear what would happen where there was not a consensus amongst family members as to whether an application should be made to the court seeking to dispense with reporting restrictions in respect of a deceased child victim. Amendment 131 enables a broad range of family members to apply for such a dispensation, including a parent, sibling, child or spouse or civil partner of the deceased child victim. Not all bereaved families will have a unified view on whether they wish the identity of their bereaved child to be made public. One family member may wish the child's identity to remain anonymous, whilst another might wish to speak publicly about the child, whether it to be to remember and celebrate their life or to raise awareness and campaign. It's hard to envisage a non-traumatising process by which family members would have to apply to court and argue either for or against the waiving of an anonymity. Amendments 139 to 146 are along a similar vein. By seeking to extend reporting restrictions in relation to publication of information which could identify deceased child victims of a crime and their families once court proceedings are underway. The issues I've already outlined apply equally to these amendments. In relation to amendments 152 to 154 concerning the court's powers in respect of the retrospective removal or reinstatement of published information which wasn't subject to reporting restrictions at the time it was published, I have concerns about how these could work in practice. And I'll not reiterate what I've already gone into for amendments 137 and 138 in group 13, but I do have the same concerns about how these amendments would work in practice and the enforceability, which would impact upon the benefits they can bring for those whom they seek to aid. Again, sorry, I will, however, reiterate what I said in Group 13. The government is keen to seek a solution to the issues raised by bereaved families and victim support organisations and to engage on those in an open-minded way. But it's essential that we fully explore those complexities involved to avoid those unintended consequences that I've alluded to this morning. I note this issue has potential implications too for the Vulnerable Witnesses and Justice Reform Scotland Bill, which also includes provisions about reporting restrictions for the protection of other victims of offences under that bill, and that's currently at stage one. As I mentioned before, the roundtable event with a range of partners in February will provide that crucial forum to discuss experiences and options, and the Cabinet Secretary and I are absolutely committed to work with Ms Squire and any other members on this matter. For the reasons outlined, I'm therefore unable to support the amendments and again would urge the member not to press in return for a commitment from the government for discussion and engagement on this extremely important issue, allowing time for the level of detailed consultation and consideration that this important and complex matter warrants beyond this bill. Yep.
Just so I'm clear of what's being proposed here, so the Minister's suggesting that there will be a round table to go away and consider all of these issues. Meanwhile, we will pass the bill as proposed at stage three, because presumably that will happen before the conclusions of the round table have come back. And then the conclusions will be amended into the passed bill, the Act, later on. Is that correct, Minister?
As far as I know, the round table is in late February, so I can't confirm that stage three would be completed by then. There are other avenues that this report restrictions could be looked at. It wouldn't necessarily be restricted to this bill. However, it could be. I'm not really sure what the member is getting at. I am laying out that I want to have as much discussion and consultation on this very important issue. The roundtable is a key part of that. And if we would be able to, if it seems right that that would be in time for stage three, then it could be.
I think I'm getting some notifications. If we do conclude today, there is a possibility that stage three could conclude by the end of February. So that is in terms of timeline. So I think that the members are just seeking some clarification around that. Okay. Willie Rennie.
It's actually following on from Liam Kerr's point. I think it's we understand there needs to be more discussion. We understand the complexity of this. But often what happens in these cases is that we agree to further discussion and consultation beyond the bill, and then there's no vehicle for delivering it. So if it's not going to be this bill, I hope the Minister has thought what bill it would be, perhaps the Victims and Witnesses Bill. And if so, has she had a discussion with the Cabinet Secretary about that as a possibility to attach this on? We want a degree of urgency about this because we know it's complex, but it shouldn't, as Ruth Maguire said, be beyond the wit of us to come up with a solution. Because my fear is, the way that you've outlined it, is that we may be making perfect the enemy of the good. The Minister's highlighted some conflicts there might be within families. Of course there will be. You get that in all legal cases in many circumstances. That doesn't mean that we shouldn't go there. We need to make sure that the courts are empowered, that the system is empowered to make the right decision in the best interest of what they believe is the balance of rights in these circumstances. So I just really want confidence from the Minister that she has thought through where this is going to happen so that we're not here in 5 years' time saying that we missed the chance. That's what I'd like confidence on.
Thanks, Mr. Rainey. And I am certain this is not a case of this being sort of kicked into the long grass. I hope I've made clear how important I really do take this and appreciate the difficulties that this causes for many families. I think it's I've highlighted numerous times how I think that because of the importance and the unintended consequences that it needs further consideration. My discussions with the Cabinet Secretary are ongoing in this. So there absolutely are other vehicles where this...
could you list what those vehicles are?
Well, the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Bill, for one. There could be, as I say, other vehicles as well for it. I just want to highlight, just before I take any further interventions, I just want to highlight one sort of account that perhaps emphasises the importance, as I say, of getting this right. During the bill's passage internationally, senators highlighted the negative impact that judgment had on bereaved families and why the bill was required to rectify the situation. Senator Fiona O'Loughlin explained that the mother of an 11-year-old boy who had been murdered was compelled recently to disguise her identity on television as though she was some type of criminal who could not be identified on the news. By revealing her identity, the identity of her dead child would also have been revealed, and it's manifestly unfair to the families of deceased children that the law operates as it does. I think that account demonstrates the complexities involved in legislating on anonymity and the need to understand how it will impact on those affected. I think while something might seem like the right thing to do, it is absolutely essential, as I've said, that it is done in the right way. So it is not about kicking this into the long grass. It is about ensuring that we do this, that we get it right for the families concerned. Happy to take intervention.
I'm very grateful. Just something occurs to me. Would it be, or has the Minister considered the possibility, following on from Willie Rennie's well-made point, that the solution to this might be to remove the sections, do the round table, and bring them back in a final format in whatever the next vehicle is, the next bill that comes forward, in order to get it right, rather than to pass something which may later need to be reviewed?
Well, I'm urging the committee to get it right. The bill, as it stands, makes provisions for victims and witnesses, but obviously, as I say, deceased victims are not covered. That's something that I think we need to have further discussion on. There are vehicles that we could make progress on that. I've been quite clear.
On that point, thank you. As far as I can hear, a number of things are being suggested by the Minister. One is that there's another bill that could be used for this, and the second is that there'll be a round table to discuss it. I'm getting a bit concerned, not least because it's not this particular Minister who's got arranging the round table, given some of the concerns we've had earlier on. So can the Minister say who's arranging that round table, what conversation she's having with the person who's arranging it, and is it not possible to bring that forward so that the bill can be the best it possibly can be? Because with respect, I think the committee is trying to do the best it possibly can by ensuring that we don't have to revisit a bill and miss an opportunity, as my colleague Willie Rennie has highlighted.
Sure. It's the Cabinet Secretary for Justice Angela Constance, who is arranging the roundtable, who has had a series of engagement, I believe, with numerous stakeholders around this. I cannot comment for the Cabinet Secretary in terms of the date of this roundtable. I know that there are a lot of different organisations and stakeholders who have been involved in this. I really can't comment on why the day is when it is. But I believe and I would assume that every effort has been made to get this in as timely a manner so that these discussions can take place as quickly as possible. There could be a number of reasons for it taking place when it is.
Further point, just if I could sum up, I think you probably gather some of the concerns from the committee, and I appreciate and empathise with the position you find yourself in terms of what you're able to control. However, would you be able to commit off the back of this discussion today to set out specifically, based on your discussions with the Cabinet Secretary for Justice, what this committee can go into stage three for us as individual members, what the basis will be? Because I'm sensing, and I can't speak for everybody, that to go into stage three with the potential that it might be looked at in a further bill or there'll be a round table at some point, feels like it's not enough given the scale of the concern over the challenge of conflicting rights. So would the Minister be able to write back to this committee once she's had a chance to affirm what the specifics is around the next steps, dates and so on?
Of course. I mean, I would say that the roundtable has been organised. It is going ahead. It's not just something that I'm saying this morning to delay things. As I say, there have been organisations, stakeholders contacted. This is a result of a series of engagements between the Cabinet Secretary, Ministers and the associated organisations and stakeholders. The roundtable is on the 20th of February. I've been very clear over the course of today and last week that there are a number of different issues outside of this one alone that I need to discuss with members around further amendments or positions for stage three. So I want to ensure that we do have time to consider issues in good time ahead of stage three. Obviously, I wouldn't be able to confirm the timings on that just now, but I will make efforts to ensure that we are able to discuss these matters prior to stage three. And I'm happy to write back with any further information in relation to the sort of timeline of how things are going to go ahead.
Minister, just at that point.
Mr. McPherson?
Yeah, thank you. To assist yourself and colleagues with these important deliberations, I think what colleagues have emphasised around the need for primary legislation opportunities to be available to act on this roundtable and any conclusions that come from it is an important point. Lawmaking, to state the obvious, is the most important bits of work that we do in this Parliament. So if the timetable for stage three does not permit the input from this roundtable to be acted upon and the actions that are agreed through that process, I do think it would be appropriate and beneficial for the Parliament to receive reassurance from you ahead of stage three that those considerations and any conclusions would input into another piece of primary legislation in this parliamentary term.
Thank you, Mr. McPherson. And yet, because what I would say is that the roundtable is a very important step in this, but it might not be the be-all and end-all. There may be other things that come out of the roundtable or things that require further discussion. I don't want to rush this to get it in a timeline for stage. As I say, the most important thing is to get it right. So if I could just finish what I'm convener. I think what I've been very clear on here is that I'm more than happy to be open and work with the committee and members on this and, yes, provide opportunities for further legislative opportunities to include this in. However, that's not saying that stage three of this bill is not the case for that. I'm just, there are options to consider there. Yes.
I appreciate that, and I appreciate the timetable as the timetable. Can the Minister explain why the roundtable isn't happening until the 20th of February then, given how important it is to the particular bill that we've got in front of us?
Sorry, Ms. Duncan-Glancy, I've already outlined the fact that it's not myself that is arranging the round table. The round table is the result of a series of discussions between the Cabinet Secretary and stakeholders and organisations who I believe are positive about the fact that this round table is happening. There could be a number of reasons why it's not happening until the 20th of February. I'm not able to go into those at the
Minister.
Moment.
You can see the committee is very involved and interested in this particular grouping. But thank you. Can I now call Ruth Maguire to wind up, press or withdraw Amendment 124, please?
Convener. I suppose the first thing I'd want to say to colleagues is it's not just the government who get to decide what bits, how legislation is formed. So I would say that. Any round table must involve the families. It absolutely must. Victims' organisations will be more than happy to share contributions, but this will be too easily dismissed if the victims' families are not there. So I would urge that the families be there. I think we could talk about the media stuff. We could probably go round in circles. One point that I would make is that it's not all media outlets who report in detail, you know, the harms that have happened to children. Many behave responsibly. Legislation would create an even playing field for them to continue to behave in a responsible manner. I don't accept that because there are international examples of where things have not worked out, that that's a reason to not legislate. I think that that's actually a gift because it shows us what not to do. It shows us we can learn from that. So I do not accept that argument. This is quite challenging because, to be frank, I've not heard the urgency and from the minister, and I feel colleagues round the table getting restless on this. What I would say to them and to the families who might be watching and the victims' organisations who've worked with them is that I'm going to take what the government have said in good faith and not press these amendments today and urge colleagues not to press them as well. However, we will not stop the campaign for these changes, the awareness raising, and I will bring them back at stage three if there's not been progress, because minds need to be sharpened and focused on the action that needs to be taken. I appreciate the complexities. It's not easy. Nothing that's worth doing is easy. But there are children currently being harmed by our legislation. The Children Care and Justice Bill is absolutely the right place to make sure that the rights of children who are involved in our care and justice system are upheld and are championed. Whether they're... I will, yeah.
I'm very grateful because Ruth Maguire, I think, is making some very, very powerful points. Does she share with me the concern that stage three and the actual processes that exist within this parliament for that element of legislation is perhaps not the best vehicle in which, as she said, the lived experience, the young people themselves can express and input into evidence. And with the greatest of respect to the minister and the Scottish Government, perhaps the round table in itself is not exactly the most fortuitous way for a young person to be able to express their concerns.
Convener, I suppose in addressing that, I would say it's the vehicle we have to legislate. I would also draw members' attention to the letter from Victim Support signed by 65 families. Now, there is, we're talking about, thankfully, a small number of families who are affected by this, but there you have access to the direct lived experience. We can see the impact. I don't think there needs to be a whole fresh consultation on this. We know what the problem is. There is access to people with lived experience. We just need a bit of urgency to get folk round the table that can work our way through this. It's not beyond us. It can't be beyond us.
Okay.
Yes.
So are you seeking to withdraw Amendment 124?
Ms. I am.
Ruth Maguire seeks to withdraw Amendment number 124. Does any member object? The amendment is therefore withdrawn. Now we move to reporting restrictions and identity of workplace, and I call Amendment 23 in the name of the Minister, grouped with Amendment 47. Minister, to move Amendment 23 and speak to both amendments in this group, please.
Thank you, Convener. Provisions in Section 12 and Section 13 of the Bill set out the relevant information which would be within scope of reporting restrictions, whether prior to or during any criminal proceedings respectively. This included information about a person's name, address, the identity of any school or other educational establishment they attend, and any still or moving picture of the person. The amendments in this group would also ensure that the reporting restrictions would also include information identifying the place at which the person works within the types of information that is included as part of reporting restrictions. Amendment 23 amends Section 12 of the Bill in that regard, and Amendment 47 does likewise in relation to Section 13 of the Bill. These amendments ensure a fuller range of identifiable information is included as part of relevant information, which is important in ensuring maximum benefit of the reporting restriction safeguards for children. This change is also important given the Bill contains provisions enabling reporting restrictions to apply or be extended beyond 18 for a child suspect or accused, and by virtue of amendments which have already been debated in Group 13 and will be debated in Group 17 for child victims and witnesses. It's more likely at this older age that these individuals will be in employment. Again, this is consistent with the reporting restrictions which have been included in the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Bill in relation to victims of certain offences listed within that bill. So I would therefore move Amendment 23 and ask members to support the other amendments in this group, the other amendment in this group.
Okay, thank you. The question is that Amendment 23 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed, so Amendment 23 is agreed. Apologies for that. I now call Amendment 24 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 20. Minister, to move formally.
Move.
The question is that Amendment 24 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Yes. Amendment 24 is therefore agreed. I call Amendment 126 in the name of Ruth Maguire, already debated with Amendment 124. Ruth Maguire, to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment... Excuse me, I'll just catch my breath. I call Amendment 123 in the name of Ruth Maguire. It says 125. Yes, that's my number dyslexia. I'll start again. I call Amendment 125 in the name of Ruth Maguire, already debated with Amendment 124. Ruth Maguire, to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 25 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 16. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 25 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Agreed. Okay, reporting restrictions, minor and technical. We'll move to that grouping now. I call Amendment 26 in the name of the Minister, group with amendments as shown in the grouping. And I point out that if Amendment 191 is agreed to, which was debated in the group reporting restrictions, powers and public interest test, I cannot call Amendment 41 through the preemption. Minister, to move Amendment 26 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. Now, I know you are looking to get through a lot of business today. Now, the majority of, well, all the amendments in this group are minor and technical amendments. I'm more than happy to go through them in detail and explain any of them if committee members desire. However, I am equally happy to move Amendment 26 if committee is agreeable.
Thank you. Do we have any? Okay. So the question is that Amendment 26 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are all agreed. Amendment 26 is agreed. I call Amendment 127 in the name of Ruth Maguire, already debated with Amendment 124. Ruth Maguire, to move or not move?
Not move.
Not moved. 127. Just let me move. Okay. The call Amendment 27 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 26. Minister to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 27 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes? Sorry, apologies. The Amendment 27 is agreed to. I call Amendment 128 in the name of Ruth Maguire, already debated with 124. Ruth Maguire to move or not move?
Not move.
Not moved. I call Amendment 28 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 26. Minister to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 28 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Thank you. We are all agreed. Amendment 29 is agreed. 28. I'll keep jumping ahead. I call Amendment 29 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 26. Minister to move formally.
Moved.
The question is Amendment 29 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. I call Amendment 129 in the name of Ruth Maguire, already debated with Amendment 124. Ruth Maguire to move or not move?
Not move.
Okay, thank you. I call Amendment 191 in the name of Martin Whitfield, already debated with Amendment 21. And I remind members that if Amendment 191 is agreed to, I cannot call Amendments 30, 31, 32, 33, 34, 35, 36, 37, 38, 39, 40, 130, 131, 132, 133, 134, 135, and 41, as shown in the grouping for preemptions. Martin Whitfield, to move or not move?
Given the undertaking from the government for discussions, I'll not move it at this stage. Convener.
That's fine. Right. I call Amendment 30 in the name of the Minister. I'm just checking after all of that big list, I'm right. Correct. I call Amendment 30 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 21. Minister to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 30 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? No, we are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour? Those against, and those abstaining. The result of the vote on Amendment 30 is 4, 9, against 0, with 1 abstention. Amendment 30 is therefore agreed. I call Amendment 31 in the name of the Minister. Already debated with Amendment 21. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 31 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of 31. Okay. Those against. And those abstaining. The result on Amendment 31 is 4, 9, against none, with 1 abstention. Amendment 31 is therefore agreed to. I call Amendment 32 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 21. Minister to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 32 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour? I'm getting dizzy with all this. Okay. Those against? And those abstaining? The result of the vote on Amendment 32 is 4, 9, against 0, with 1 abstention. Amendment 32 is therefore agreed to. I call Amendment 33 in the name of the Minister, already debated, debated with Amendment 21. Minister, to move formally?
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 33 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour? Okay. Those against? And those abstaining? The result of the vote on Amendment 33 is yes 9, against 0, with one abstention. Amendment 33 is therefore agreed. I call Amendment 130 in the name of Ruth Maguire, already debated with Amendment 124. Ruth Maguire, to move or not move?
Not move, Commissioner.
Not moved. I call Amendment 131 in the name of Ruth Maguire, already debated with Amendment 124. Ruth Maguire, to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 34 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 21. A Minister to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 34 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 34. Okay, those against and those abstaining. Okay, the result of the vote on Amendment 34 is for 9, against 0, with one abstention. Amendment 34 is therefore agreed. I call Amendment 35 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 21. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 35 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour? Those against? Those abstaining? The result on the vote of Amendment 35 is for 9, against 0, with one abstention. Amendment 35 is therefore agreed. I call Amendment 36 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 21. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 36 be agreed. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 36. Those against? Those abstaining? The result of the vote on Amendment 36 is for 9, against 0, with one abstention. Amendment 36 is therefore agreed. I call Amendment 132 in the name of Ruth Maguire, already debated with Amendment 124. Ruth Maguire, to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 37 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 21. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 37 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour? Those against? And those abstaining? The result of the vote on Amendment 37 is for 9, against 0, with one abstention. Therefore, Amendment 37 is agreed. Call Amendment 38 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 21. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 38 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 38. Those against? And those abstaining? The result of the vote on Amendment 38 is for 7, against 2, with 1 abstention. Amendment 38 is therefore agreed. I call Amendment 133 in the name of Ruth Maguire, already debated with Amendment 124. Ruth Maguire, to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 134 in the name of Ruth Maguire, already debated with 124. Ruth Maguire, to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 39 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 21. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 39 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
No. We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour? Well done. Those against, and those abstaining. Okay. The result of the vote on the Amendment 39 is 4-7, against 2, with 1 abstention. Amendment 39 is therefore agreed. I call Amendment 40 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 21. Minister, to move formally. The question is that Amendment 40 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour? Those against? And those abstaining. Okay, thank you. The result of the vote on Amendment 40 is 4-9, against 0, with 1 abstention. Amendment 40 is therefore agreed to. I call Amendment 135 in the name of Ruth Maguire, already debated with Amendment 124. Ruth Maguire, to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 41 in the name of, the Minister, already debated with Amendment 26. Minister, to move formally or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 41 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Can I just check with... Thank you. We are all agreed. Thank you. I call Amendment 136 in the name of Ruth Maguire, already debated with Amendment 124. Ruth Maguire, to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 42 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 21. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
Sorry, I'm just... It's missing. The question is that Amendment 42 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour? Those against? And those abstaining? The result of the vote on Amendment 42 is 4-9, against 0, with 1 abstention. Amendment 42 is therefore agreed. We'll be taking a short suspension till I find my place in this here. Okay, thank you. Thank you for that. A brief suspension. We're back online, back on track. I call Amendment 43 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 16. The Minister to move formally. Okay. The question is that Amendment 43 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We're all agreed. I call Amendment 137 in the name of Ruth Maguire, already debated with Amendment 21. Ruth Maguire to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 138 in the name of Ruth Maguire, already debated with Amendment 21. Ruth Maguire to move or not move?
Not move.
Next question is that section 12 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
Yes. Section 12 is agreed. So, section 13. I call Amendment 44 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 21. Minister to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 44 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour? Those against? Those abstaining? The result of the vote on Amendment 44 is 4-9, against 0, with 1 abstention. Amendment 44 is therefore agreed. I call Amendment 45 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 21. Minister to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 45 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? No. We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour? My hands up. Sorry. Those against? And those abstaining. The result of the vote on Amendment 45 is 4-9 against 0 and 1 abstention. Amendment 45 is therefore agreed. I call Amendment 46 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 22. Minister to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 46 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are all agreed. I call Amendment 139 in the name of Ruth Maguire, already debated with Amendment 124. Ruth Maguire to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 47 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 23. Minister to move formally. The question is that Amendment 47 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We're all agreed. Are you keeping up? I call Amendment 48 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 20. Minister to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 48 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes. Well, yes, we are all agreed. Okay. I call Amendment 140 in the name of Ruth Maguire, already debated with 124. Ruth Maguire to move or not move?
Not move.
Not move. I call Amendment 49 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 20. Minister to move formally.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 49 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We're all agreed. I call Amendment 50 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 20. Minister to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 50 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes, we are all agreed. I call Amendment 141 in the name of Ruth Maguire, already debated with 124. Ruth Maguire to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 142 in the name of Ruth Maguire, already debated with 124. Ruth Maguire to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 51 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 121. Minister, to move formally?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 51 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour? Those against? And those abstaining? The result of the vote on Amendment 51 is for 9, against 0, with 1 abstention. Amendment 51 is therefore agreed to. I call Amendment 52 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 16. Minister, to move formally. The question is that Amendment 52 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I call Amendment 53 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 26. Ministers, to move formally. The question is that Amendment 53 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are all agreed. I call Amendment 143 in the name of Ruth Maguire, already debated with Amendment 124. And I remind members that if Amendment 143 is agreed to, I cannot call Amendment 54 in the preemption. Ruth Maguire to move or not move?
Not move.
Okay. I call Amendment 54, is that right? Mm-hmm. In the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 21. Minister to move formally. The question is that Amendment 54 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Just checking. No. We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour? Those against? And those abstaining? The result of Amendment 54 is for 9, against 0, and 1 abstention. Amendment 54 is therefore agreed to. I call Amendment 55 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 21. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 55 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour? And those against? And those abstaining. The result of Amendment 55 is for 9, against 0, and with 1 abstention. Amendment 55 is therefore agreed. I call Amendment 144 in the name of Ruth Maguire, already debated with Amendment 124. Ruth Maguire to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 56 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 26. Minister to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 56 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. I call Amendment 57 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 26. Minister to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 57 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are all agreed. I call Amendment 145 in the name of Ruth Maguire, already debated with 124. Ruth Maguire to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 58 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 26. Minister to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 58 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes, we are all agreed. Can we break? I'm looking at the clock and I know we're on a bit of a run here, but I think we need to take our break as scheduled, if that's okay. So I suspend for 15-minute break, okay? Make sure we all know where we are. Welcome back. Thank you very much for that, being back in after a short break. So, right back in where we left off. And I call Amendment 59 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 26. Minister, to move formally. The question is that Amendment 59 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes, we're all agreed. I call Amendment 146 in the name of Ruth Maguire, already debated with Amendment 124. Ruth Maguire, to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendments 60, 61, 62, 63 and 64 in the name of the Minister, already debated. I will invite the Minister to move Amendments 60 to 64 on block. Does any member object to a single question being put on Amendment 60 to 64? Okay. Is there a specific amendment that you are objecting to?
It's my intention to abstain on 60, 61 and 62 and to vote for 63 and 64. If that is helpful, Convener.
Okay, you hold on a minute.
So can we do 60 to 62 on block?
Okay, so... Right, can I ask that we take a single question on Amendment 60 to 62 on block? Are we all agreed? Okay. So
you put the question, Amendment 60 to 62, agreed to?
Are Amendments 60 to 62 agreed to? No, you just...
So we're taking them on board, but you need a vote until she's...
Okay.
Yeah.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of 60 to 62. Those against? And those abstaining? The result of votes on Amendments 60 to 62 are 4, 9 against 1 with 1 abstention. Therefore, Amendments 60 to 62 are agreed. I caught a question.
Did you say against 1 or against none?
Against none.
Okay, thank you.
So, 9
or 1?
That's 4, 9 against none.
Yeah.
Abstained 1. Right. The question is, has the Amendment 63 be agreed to? Are we all agreed? Yes, we're agreed. The question is that Amendment 64 be agreed to? Are we all agreed? Yes, 64 is agreed. I call Amendment 147 in the name of Ruth Maguire, already debated with Amendment 21. Ruth Maguire, to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 65 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 21. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 65 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 65? Those against? And those abstaining? The result of the vote on Amendment 65 is 4, 9, against 0, with 1 abstention. Amendment 65 is therefore agreed. I call Amendment 66 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 21. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 66 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour? Those against? And those abstaining? Why Right. The result of the vote on Amendment 66 is 4-9 against 0 with one abstention. Amendment 66 is therefore agreed. I call Amendment 67 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 21. Minister, to move formally.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 67 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour? Those against? And those abstaining? Is that your hand? Yep. The result of the vote on Amendment 67 is 4-9, against 0, with one abstention. Amendment 67 is therefore agreed. I call Amendment 148 in the name of Ruth Maguire, already debated with Amendment 21. Ruth Maguire, to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 192 in the name of Ruth Maguire, already debated with Amendment 21. Excuse me. Ruth Maguire, to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 149 in the name of Ruth Maguire, already debated with Amendment 21. Ruth Maguire, to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 150 in the name of Ruth Maguire, already debated with Amendment 21. Ruth Maguire, to move or not move?
Not move.
Okay, here we go. I call Amendments 68, 69, 70, 71, 72, 73, 74, 75... I'm just keeping myself right here as well, sorry. 75, 76, 77, 78, 79, 80, 81, 82, 83, 84, in the name of the Minister, already debated. I invite the Minister to move amendments 68 to 84 on block. Does any member object to a single question being put on these amendments 68 to 84?
Yes, I object.
Okay. If any, can I ask the member, Mr. Kerr, to put which amendments it is that he is objecting to on block?
You could do, convener, but with respect, I think you just need to call, right? You've proposed putting it on block, and I object to that.
That's what I just did. Sorry. Okay. Right. The question is, we'll just do them all individually. Right. The question is that Amendment 68 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
No. We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 68... Okay, oh sorry, those against? Got to do the next bit. And those abstaining? Right. The result on Amendment 68 is 4-9 against 0 with one abstention. Amendment 68 is therefore agreed. The question is that Amendment 69 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of... please raise your hands. Amendment 69. Those against? Those abstaining? So the result of the vote on Amendment 69 is 4-7, 2 against with 1 abstention. Amendment 69 is therefore agreed. The question is that Amendment 70 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 70... Those against? And those abstaining? The result of the vote on Amendment 70 is agreed 9, for 9, against 0, 1 abstention. Amendment 70 is therefore agreed. The question is that Amendment 71 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour? Those against? And those abstaining? The result of the vote on Amendment 71 is 4, 9, against 0, with 1 abstention. Amendment 71 is therefore agreed. The question is that Amendment 72 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 72? Those against? And those abstaining? The result of the vote on Amendment 72 is 4, 7, against 2, and 1 abstention. Amendment 72 is therefore agreed. The question is that Amendment 73 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes, we are all agreed.
No.
She needs to keep up. We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 73. Those against, and those abstaining. The result of the vote on Amendment 73 is 4, 9, against 0, with 1 abstention. Amendment 73 is therefore agreed to. The question is that Amendment 74 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 74? Those against, and those abstaining. Yeah. The result of Amendment 74 is 4, 9, against 0, with 1 abstention. Amendment 74 is therefore agreed. The question is that Amendment 75 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 75... Those against, and those abstaining. I have to slow down. No, you can't. No. The result of the vote on Amendment 75 is 4, 9, against 0, with 1 abstention. Amendment 75 is therefore agreed. The next question is Amendment 76 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 76. Those against? And those abstaining? The result on Amendment 76 is 4, 7, against 2, with 1 abstention. Amendment 76 is therefore agreed. The question Amendment 77 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. 77.
Yes.
Yeah, thank you. Those in favour of Amendment 77? Those against, and those abstaining. The results of the vote on Amendment 77 is 4, 9, against 0 and with 1 abstention. The Amendment 77 is therefore agreed. The next question is Amendment 78 to be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 78. Those against? And those abstaining? The result of the vote on Amendment 78 is 4, 9, against 0, with 1 abstention. Amendment 78 is therefore agreed. The question is that Amendment 79 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour, Amendment 79. Those against, and those abstaining. The result of the vote on Amendment 79 are 4, 9, against 0, with 1 abstention. Amendment 79 is therefore agreed. The next question is that Amendment 80 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. The next question is Amendment 81 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 81? Okay, those against? And those abstaining? The result of the vote on Amendment 81 is 4, 7, against 2, with 1 abstention. The Amendment 81 is therefore agreed. The question is that Amendment 82 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 82? Okay. Those against? And those abstaining? The result of the vote on Amendment 82 is 4, 9, against 0, with 1 abstention. Amendment 82 is therefore agreed. Can I ask the next question? Amendment 83 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The question is that Amendment 84 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We'll just get our page. Here we are. I call Amendment 151. Already debated with Amendment 21. Ruth Maguire to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 152 in the name of Ruth Maguire. Already debated with Amendment 124. Ruth Maguire to move or not move?
Not move.
Okay. What's a big amendment? I call Amendment 153 in the name of Ruth Maguire, already debated with Amendment 124. Ruth Maguire to move or not move?
Not move.
Okay. Catch my breath. 154 now. I call Amendment 154 in the name of Ruth Maguire, already debated with Amendment 124. Ruth Maguire to move or not move?
Not move.
Okay. So the next question is that Section 13 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes, thank you. So now we're moving on to Section 14. The rights and welfare of children involved in criminal proceedings. I call Amendment 193 in the name of Martin Whitfield, group with amendments as shown in the grouping. Martin Whitfield to move Amendment 193 and speak to all other amendments in this group. Thank you.
I'm very grateful, Convener. And obviously this section deals with, from the bill, the steps to safeguard the welfare and safety of children in criminal proceedings. And the proposals of the amendments that I bring in my name are to include better provision to take account for the young people themselves, and also to instill into various sections the obligations to consider not just the welfare and the safety, but also the rights of young people. A number of the amendments are short and allow, in particular, for provision of Amendment 196 to add a section to Section 14 of the bill, to itself add a section to the 1995 Act. And this is to allow a child to have the opportunity to express their views in a way that the young person themselves prefers. We've already heard in a number of amendments moved this morning, and indeed the position of the Scottish Government, that the young person themselves, their role, their maturity, their ability needs to be taken into account. And as a consequence of that, we also need to take into account the manner in which the young person can express their preferences, express their understanding. And this would extend to the regards that the child has, taking into account particularly their age and maturity. And I've already pressed the government in respect of the test that would be applied to this, and the government have offered discussions on it. All of these amendments that sit here refer to really that decision on the importance of a young person being able to firstly understand what's happening to them, secondly be in a position where they can, as far as is practicable, be comfortable with those that are around them so that they can express their views, and more importantly, that what is happening to the young person is understandable to the young person, and in particular the consequences of decisions they may be asked to make in circumstances where it would be understandable, and I think it is higher than that, but I will just leave it at, it would be understandable that the young person is concerned, stressed, and emotive. And I think, given the purpose that sits behind this bill, the requirement to try and make that journey, if not as comfortable, but as understandable to the young person, appropriate to their age, and understanding, is important. I could go into some detail with regard to specific amendments, but I will, again, having detailed 196, look to 198 and a subsequent number of the amendments, which removes the may to insert the must, so that the requirements sit as a must on not just those adults immediately around them, but those adults that are contained in the administrative processes must take account of the young person. I have nothing really further to add on that, but I will respond if any of the committee members have questions, or indeed to any comments that the Minister may make at a subsequent date. But I speak to and will move 193 all the way through to 204 as appropriate when required. I'm grateful, Convener.
Thank you, Mr. Whitfield. And can I ask Pam Duncan-Glancy now to speak to Amendment 205 and other amendments in the group? Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. And I'd just like to start by saying that I support the amendments in this grouping in my colleague Martin Whitfield's name. I think it's incredibly important that any young person is supported to fully understand the process in which they're going through, and would echo all that he said so far. My amendment 205 in this grouping would require that where a child was subject to proceedings is residing with an individual who's committed a domestic abuse offence or has been witness to domestic abuse, a referral is to be made to a specialist domestic abuse provider. This, I think, is recognition of the fact that many young people, for example, who have been remitted at ages 16 and 17 to young offenders institutes, 60% of them had witnessed domestic violence. I think this provision acknowledges the unique vulnerabilities of children who've been in an abusive environment. And in speaking to that amendment, similar amendments in earlier groupings, I highlighted that children who witness abuse may also suffer emotional, psychological, developmental challenges. And I emphasised then, and would re-emphasise now, the need for targeted specialist support and intervention delivered in a safe and secure environment so that the child is able to express their feelings and experiences, process emotions, build resilience, and develop coping mechanisms. mechanisms. As I've also said earlier, I think it's really important that as many touch points with the state as possible, such as this, are used as an opportunity to identify where support could be needed in a domestic abuse situation and to provide it at the earliest opportunity, which I think is going to be critical in mitigating the potential long-term effects on mental and emotional wellbeing and contributing to the child's overall health and recovery from trauma. And so on that basis, I urge committee members to support amendment number 205 in my name and the others in this group in the name of Martin Whitfield.
Thank you. Minister, can I call yourself now?
Thank you, convener. Now, I appreciate the intent behind these amendments, but I do have some concerns and issues with each of them, which I will lay out just now. Amendments 193 and 194 are similar to amendment 165 that the member withdrew last week in respect of the children's hearing system. The amendments would seem unnecessary as the courts already have extensive obligations under the ECHR and the UNCRC. Additionally, the task of balancing a child's rights as well as their welfare can be even more challenging in the criminal justice system. For example, a child's right to liberty is not a definitive one and can be interfered with if justified under the ECHR and UNCRC. So while the child's rights and welfare are of course a primary consideration, they're not always the paramount consideration. Therefore, this amendment would seem unworkable. Amendments 195 to 197 seem to be based on provisions from the Children Scotland Act 2020, which these amendments would insert into the Criminal Procedure Scotland Act 1995. However, the provisions in the 2020 Act were drafted to account for the views of younger children, particularly those under 12, in the unique context of children's hearings proceedings. Inserting those into the criminal justice environment fails to account for the inherent differences between the two forums. Amendments 195 to 197 would also seem an ill fit for the criminal setting because the courts would... I would rather take them at the end. Amendments 195 to 197 are also an ill fit for the criminal setting because the courts, unlike the children's hearing, will not be dealing with the prosecution of children under the age of criminal responsibility. And so it is not necessary for there to be presumptions regarding their capacity to give a view in such situations. Furthermore, under Article 12 of the UNCRC, a child has the right to express their view freely and must be provided the opportunity to provide their view in any judicial proceedings. The court is required to act compatibly with ECHR and UNCRC. The intention behind all of Amendments 193 through to 197 is already realised via existing legislation or the application of internal obligations. So on this basis, I would be opposed to these amendments. On amendments 198 through to 202, these roll back the flexibility afforded to the court in section 14 of the bill to decide on a case-by-case basis whether it is appropriate to sit in a different building, different day, or put in place closed court measures. These amendments would require the court to do these things on a blanket basis. We've discussed these proposals with criminal justice agencies, and there would appear to be various issues. Firstly, these amendments place duties on courts with limited or no flexibility or discretion, so they are unduly prescriptive. There is a risk that these amendments interfere with the court's powers to consider each case in an appropriate rights-compliant way, given potential rights considerations of all parties, including that of the adult co-accused, thereby potentially interfering with judicial independence. Secondly, these changes have not been fully consulted on with Scottish Courts and Tribunal Services or the judiciary, the very agencies that these changes would affect. However, based on contact with SCTS, including their response to the consultation on the bill and that of the Summary Sheriffs Association, they are unlikely to be supportive. And I think we must be very careful to ensure that we do not encroach on the independence of the judiciary and that we do not constrain its discretion. The courts are best placed to make case-by-case decisions, and these amendments would appear to overstep their responsibility and expertise in this domain. Essentially, the amendments would have corresponding resource implications. They could result in delays in a child's case being progressed if, for example, the case could only be held on different days from other courts in that building. And that would have implications not just for the accused, but for the victims and witnesses. They would have serious implications for court's programming and capacity more broadly, thereby impacting more widely just on cases involving a child accused. The changes would be challenging, if not almost impossible, to implement in each court, particularly in smaller courts that only have one courtroom available or where there is only one sheriff who already has criminal business set down for the day. SCTS clearly expressed these concerns in the consultation response, and they have reiterated these to my officials in respect of these amendments. Whilst some of these amendments are already requirements in certain cases, they would have particular challenges in solemn proceedings. Additional considerations in these cases, such as the need for juries and noting the number of buildings in Scotland which are set up to accommodate jury trials, is limited, as well as the requirement for police presence, access to cells and holding areas before or after court appearances, inherently limit where these cases could take place. There would also be challenges where, for example, there's a child in custody and timescales prescribed in legislation require the case to call on a particular date or before the expiry of a particular period. If other court business was already scheduled and required to happen on that particular date and the child's case could not take place in that same building or on the same day as the court business and no other appropriate facilities are available, the courts would need to decide which case should take place, and knowing that to do so would mean legislative requirements would not be met. This could be a particular issue in smaller or more remote courts. These amendments would also seem to apply to every court hearing from the first calling until the case concludes, which could only compound these challenges further. Amendments 200 and 203 are problematic for a number of reasons, including that the co-accused's rights here would appear to be given less weight than the child's. In human rights law, a right does not require serious interference to be infringed, so this amendment arguably would distort existing legal protections. In contrast to what is in Section 14 of the Bill, the amendment unduly constrains the discretion of the court to make decisions on a case-by-case basis, in line with our duties under the Human Rights Act 98, to do all of this in a rights-compliant way. Given these risks, I could not support these amendments. Amendment 204 inserts a new subsection into Section 305 of the 95 Criminal Procedure Act to expressly provide that the High Court may, by act of adjournal, also make provision for the purpose of ensuring that criminal proceedings involving a child are concluded in a way that accords with the needs of the child. Again, while I understand the intent here, the amendment raises a number of issues. The judiciary has not been consulted on the matter, and the High Court is responsible for making acts of adjournal. Amendments to court conduct, practices and processes in respect of children can already be made, informed by a combination of existing legislation, practice notes, court rules and procedure, and guidance. These considerations and amendments for children at court by virtue of their age are in addition to other supports that may be provided owing to a child's vulnerabilities. On Amendment 205, committee last week discussed a similar amendment concerning referrals in the children's hearing system, and in those circumstances I agreed to discuss further with the member regarding the definitions contained within that amendment. And I should reiterate that I am absolutely in full agreement with the member about the fundamental principle of ensuring appropriate and timely access to support services in cases of domestic abuse. However, I would not be supportive of Amendment 205. Firstly, I don't think this is appropriate responsibility for the court. It does not seem to be a role of a judge or sheriff or the Scottish Courts and Tribunal Service, whose function is to provide administrative support to our courts and tribunals and to the judiciary. The number of children the amendment could cover could also be significant. However, I did talk earlier in terms of appropriate and timely access to support services in those cases of domestic abuse. And with that in mind, I would refer to the Victim Information and Advice Service, which is already provided by the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service in criminal court cases. When a case is received, COPS will consider and can refer any victims who should receive extra support to Victim Information and Advice Services, and this includes any child victim or victim of domestic abuse. It can, in such cases, already put the child in touch with other services that offer practical and emotional support, and in such a case, it would be for the individual to decide whether they wish to access that support. If I could continue on my points, and I'm happy to at the end. The member asked last week where responsibility for referring a child should sit, and where an offence is reported to the police will usually provide information about victim support organisations. Although I note Police Scotland's previous evidence to the committee that this is not always the most appropriate time to provide such information. So I think the key surely must be to ensure access to appropriate support throughout the child's journey through the justice system, and not just at the point where it meets the court process. On all occasions requiring police attendance when children are present during a domestic incident, or where they reside in a household where such an incident takes place, regardless of their presence, officers in attendance will consider all information, including previous incidents, to assess whether there is a child wellbeing or child protection concern. And this response is outlined in our child protection guidance. Domestic abuse is always a wellbeing concern, and whilst I can't get into a full discussion about information sharing as set out in, for example, Getting It Right for Every Child guidance, information can be shared in a lawful, appropriate and proportionate way if there are concerns about protecting a child or a young person's wellbeing. Reasonable efforts must be made to inform the child or young person and appropriate family members that this information has been shared. Almost all local authorities operate multi-agency risk assessment conferences as one of part of a multi-agency risk management work for domestic abuse cases. MIRACs also allow for the sharing of relevant risk-focused information in a safe environment to support the development of a coordinated multi-agency safety plan to increase victim safety. Any specialist support that a victim might require can be part of such considerations. Such cases might involve child protection concerns if there is evidence that significant harm has occurred or may occur, with clear multi-agency procedures based on national guidance requiring to be followed in such cases. The response in such cases could include referral to specialist support services. I cannot therefore support these amendments and urge members not to press amendments 193 through to 205. I would encourage the committee to reject these if pressed.
Minister, you said you would take questions from members now. Martin Whitfield, you were first, I believe.
Do you want me to sum up 493 as
well?
Well,
no, it was questions.
Oh, just questions. Oh,
well, you had some points you wanted to raise,
yes,
but the Minister,
so
you said you would take it.
In relation to the statement, I'm grateful, convener, in relation to the statements that the Minister has made, is she prepared to share the response that her officers, her officials have received? From, in essence, the judiciary about the response to this. There are a number of matters that the Minister has raised that fundamentally boil down to apparently the Scottish Government's disagreement to add rights after welfare throughout this bill. And yet what we're talking about when we're talking about legislation are the rights that are given or indeed are taken away in response to that coming together of a young person and the criminal justice system and indeed the welfare system and indeed most aspects of a young person's life. The rights of a child sit above that. We debated long and hard the UNCRC within this parliament over a long period of time, and there was across the chamber very strong agreement about the hierarchy of protections that young people have, and sitting at the top of those are rights. But there has always been the question of a challenge between one individual's rights and another individual's rights, and the entire process of the court system, the environment of that decision making, is about balancing those rights. But we have heard in the chamber and indeed in the enactment that across the chamber and in Scotland, we put children's rights at the top of that. And that doesn't mean that they're applied every time. It means that where children's rights have to give way to some other individual's rights, it is done so only in an exceptional circumstances and for exceptional reasons. And of course, even with the amendments that I've proposed here, there are facilities for that to happen in any event. With regard to the statements relating to the court and resource, again, with respect, it seems to be we can't do this because of resource. Of course there are challenges. There are always challenges. There were challenges when the number of courts across Scotland were closed and people made representations about it. But I think we're in a very dangerous position if we're saying to our young people that actually the resources aren't there to make it particular for your case, and therefore that's not important. And that particularly arises in relation to the amendment regarding co-accused 204 and the act of a journal from the courts. Even with this amendment, there would still be the exceptional circumstances where the court could act in what's right. However, the presumption would be that the procedure a court would adopt would be one that accords with the needs of the child, which I would suggest in a co-accused case must always take the priority over an adult co-accused. I have thought long and hard and struggled long and hard to find a situation where an individual child's rights who was a co-accused with an adult, it is their rights that would give way to the adult, simply from the point of views of competency, understanding and age. So in this sort of question section, I'm sorry I'm adjourning.
I was hoping for a question rather than you, Mr.
Well, it's difficult because of the... I understand that, Convener, and I'll leave it at that point and I will sum up.
My sum up will be much shorter. Yeah. Would you want to respond to some of those points?
Yes, Minister? I'd be grateful. Thank you, Convener. So in terms of the judiciary response to the consultation, this is already publicly available, but I'm more than happy to share that after this session. In terms of the comments around the balancing of rights and welfare, not including rights, the rights of a child are currently enshrined in ECHR and UNCRC, and I know that the member is aware of that. But the courts do have a duty to act on these, and I'm confident that that is what they will do. It would be for the courts to look at these cases on a case-by-case basis, acting on the responsibilities under UNCRC and under ECHR. I'm sorry, Convener, I'm responding to another comments from another intervention. So in terms of the challenges with resource that Mr. Whitfield raised, and I understand that, I don't want to say no, it's a case of no, that we can't do it. But at the moment, for the reasons I have outlined, if the amendments were to pass in their current form, this could possibly impact on children's rights today, tomorrow, and that's not something that I would be comfortable with. So whether that's something that we need to look at going forward, absolutely. But in terms of these amendments, as I say, they could impact on children's rights immediately. And in terms of the co-accused, now, again, this is down to the court to look at on a case-by-case basis. I think that the amendments in this are problematic for a number of reasons, including, as I said, that the co-accused rights here would appear to be given less weight than the child's. And I appreciate the members' comments around this. But again, I think this is down to the courts to make the decision on that on a case-by-case basis rather than sort of putting that in statute, because we have, as I said in my opening comments, in human rights law, a right does not have require serious interference to be infringed. And I think that this argument, amendment, distorts the existing legal protections and confuses matters. So, and essentially, to sum up, I believe that a lot of what is covered in these amendments is already covered under ECHR and UNCRC, and I believe that we have to give the judiciary and the courts their discretion to look at these matters on a case-by-case basis. So, I would not support those amendments.
Thank you. And I just, you know, this is a stage two proceeding, and I really do want to encourage debate as much as possible on this. And so I will be bringing in members Pam Duncan Clancy and then Liam Kerr, who have got questions on this, and I hope the Minister will address those. Pam Duncan Clancy.
Thank you, Convener, and I appreciate that. It does feel a bit peculiar that it's almost like more of a statement as opposed to a bit of a debate where interventions are taken, which makes it quite difficult to have a detailed discussion on very detailed parts of legislation, which, of course, this is about. To the substance of my intervention, the Minister, on the other amendments, actually, in Martin Whitfield's name, the Minister seems to be saying that part of the concern is around not about the particular overreach into the judiciary. I'll leave that for a moment, but the other concern is that it could delay processes because the buildings aren't, there might not be enough buildings, or it might have to be moved. And I'll look forward to debating my amendment on the numbers of panel members later, because that too, I think, could frustrate and delay some aspects of justice. So I hope the Minister will take a similar view. I'm a bit concerned, though, that at this point, the Minister's relying on the fact that the ECHR and the UNCRC are enough, given that, first of all, the ECHR is legislation that we would hope, international legislation we would hope, of course, that the courts adhere to, but there's reasons why we brought domestic legislation in this area, for example, the UNCRC, and this is an opportunity to enact part of the UNCRC, which may not be all covered, all aspects of this bill be covered because of the changes that had to be made to that legislation recently through amendments. So that kind of that concerns me slightly. On the points the Minister's made around my amendment number 205 on domestic abuse and violence, I can't see why, in everything that the Minister has said, why my amendment would be a problem to that. In fact, it appears to me that all it would do would be to strengthen the ability of the state to provide support, so that, because it's well known the failures that, particularly for women who've experienced domestic violence, it's well known the failures that can happen in the justice system. And so every point at which we've got an opportunity to address that, we should be. And I believe that my amendment 205 does that. And I see no reason, on the basis of what the Minister set out, why she wouldn't support that.
Thank you. Just to be clear, my statements are quite long. I'm more than happy to take interventions. I'm more than happy to have
debate. Minister.
But I was sorry, convener. Okay. I was responding to comments from another intervention, so it's just a little bit difficult there. In terms of Ms Duncan Glancy's comments, I've been clear that I believe the amendments would result in duplication and complexity. In terms of the Ms Duncan Glancy's own amendment, I have laid out the reasoning for not supporting this. I do believe that that support should be in place prior to the point that it meets the court process, and I've laid out the avenues for that to be possible. If we need to look at if Ms Duncan Glancy is saying that that is not always happening or that needs to be improved, then that's certainly something that we perhaps need to look into. But as I say, I think that that support for domestic abuse is required at a much earlier stage than at the point where it meets the court process. So that would be yes.
Thank you. I appreciate that. And my amendment doesn't undo any of that. It literally adds another point at which someone could be caught from the system, another safety net, as it were, to ensure that that support would be in place.
Thank you.
Mr Kerr?
Just something, Minister, if I could just clarify with you. Earlier during your statement, but particularly during a response to Martin Whitfield, you said you were, and I'm quoting, confident the courts, end quote, will do something. You said one of the amendments will possibly impact on rights, and then you said, I think this amendment distorts existing legal protections. And I just wonder, can you help the committee understand, have you received any formal legal advice that gets you to that position to reject these amendments, or is this just what you think?
No, I believe that I said in my comments that we had, that officials had been discussing this matter with key stakeholders, and I've said I'm more than happy to share details on that.
That's not quite what I asked, Minister. I asked if you'd received formal legal advice when arriving at your position of confidence and thinking this amendment distorts things.
Yes.
Thank you.
Ms Thompson?
Yeah, picking up a tiny thing from that point, around this issue of rights, as part of that consideration, have you considered if, in the event of the UK government wishing to remove us from, like, rights, ECHR, for example, to what extent that would implicate the rights provisioning within this bill? Because that has been presented as a very real possibility, if not a threat.
Be very concerning, and it stretches much further than just the implications of this bill. However, we would still be compliant with UNCRC in relation to that.
So. Have you had advice? advice on that, because I suppose I'm just probing a bit more about the rights-based element and the extent to which you can be confident in all potential legal scenarios. So are you confident that the advice you've received thus far takes cognizance of that as a possibility from the point of view of children's rights?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Can I now invite Martin Whitfield to wind up, press or withdraw Amendment 193, please?
I'm very grateful, Convener. I am concerned because, of course, the amendments are to the 1995 Act, which, unless expressly brought in within the UNCRC, won't be covered by it, and young people will have to rely on the already exist or pre-existing vehicles to do so, which the committee member, Michelle Thompson, has highlighted may indeed be a vehicle that's not available in the future. I would say I'm quite disappointed at the approach that's been taken with regard to these amendments, because they were tabled in good faith, and as the government have sought to seek reliance for the authority of passing their amendments, these are of course also supported by the Children's Commissioner. So with that in mind, I will press 193, Convener.
Is that Amendment 193 be agreed to? Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 193? Tell me when you've got me. Those against? No abstentions? Has everyone voted? Yep. Okay. Thanks. The result of the vote on Amendment 193 is 4 against 6. Amendment 193 is therefore not agreed. I call Amendment 194 in the name of Martin Whitfield, already debated with Amendment 193. Martin Whitfield to move or not move?
Move.
The question is that Amendment 194 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 194? Those against?
No abstentions.
And no abstentions. So the result of the vote on Amendment 194 is 4 against 6 with no abstentions. The Amendment 194 is therefore not agreed. I call Amendment 195 in the name of Martin Whitfield, already debated with 193. Martin Whitfield to move or not move?
Move.
The question is that Amendment 195 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 195? And those against? No abstentions. So the result of the vote on Amendment 195 is 4 against 6 with no abstentions. Amendment 195 is therefore not agreed. Next, I call Amendment 196 in the name of Martin Whitfield, already debated with Amendment 193. Martin Whitfield to move or not move?
Given the results in 195, I will not move.
Okay. I call Amendment 197 in the name of Martin Whitfield, already debated with 193 amendment. Martin Whitfield to move or not move?
Move.
The question is Amendment 197 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? No. We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 197? And those against? No abstentions? Okay. The result of the vote on Amendment 197 is 4 against 6 with no abstentions. Amendment 197 is therefore not agreed. I call Amendment 198 in the name of Martin Whitfield, already debated with Amendment 193. Martin Whitfield to move or not move? The question is that Amendment 198 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 198, raise your hands. Those against? The result of the vote on Amendment 198 is 4-4, against 6, and no abstentions. Amendment 198 is therefore not agreed. I call Amendment 199 in the name of Martin Whitfield, already debated with Amendment 193. Martin Whitfield, to move or not move?
Given the result of 198, I will not move.
Okay. I call Amendment 200 in the name of Martin Whitfield, already debated with Amendment 193. Martin Whitfield, to move or not move?
Move.
The question is that Amendment 200 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? No. We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 200, raise your hands. And those against? And no abstentions. The result of the vote on Amendment 200 is 4-4, against 6, with no abstentions. Amendment 200 is therefore not agreed. I call Amendment 201 in the name of Martin Whitfield, already debated with Amendment 193. Martin Whitfield, to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 202 in the name of Martin Whitfield, already debated with Amendment 193. Martin Whitfield, to move or not move?
Not move.
I call Amendment 203 in the name of Martin Whitfield, already debated with Amendment 193. Martin Whitfield, to move or not move?
Move.
The question is that Amendment 203 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 203, raise your hands. And those against? No abstentions. Okay, the result of the vote on Amendment 203 is 4-4, against 6, with no abstentions. Amendment 203 is therefore not agreed. The next question is that Section 14 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Right, I'll just take a wee breath. I now call Amendment 204 in the name of Martin Whitfield, already debated with 193. Martin Whitfield, to move or not move?
Move.
The question is that Amendment 204 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? No, there's some shaking of heads here. We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 204? Those against 204? And no abstentions. Okay. The result of the vote on Amendment 204 is 4-4, against 6, with no abstentions. Amendment 204 is therefore not agreed. I call Amendment 205 in the name of Pam Duncan-Glancy, already debated with Amendment 193. Pam Duncan-Glancy, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is therefore that Amendment 205 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 205? Those against? No abstentions? The result of the vote on Amendment 205 is 4-4. Against 6, with no abstentions. Amendment 205 is therefore not agreed. So we now move on to Section 15, the remit to children's hearings from criminal courts. And I call Amendment 85 in the name of Ros McCall, group with amendments as shown in the grouping, with Ros McCall to now move Amendment 85 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. First time to speak today. Good. These amendments were actually a balancing set of amendments that were based on previous amendments that were put forward from last week that didn't end up being moved in the end. They were designed to allow the courts to refer to the children's hearing process if deemed appropriate as to the treatment of the child, where the child pleads guilty or is found guilty of an offence in solemn proceedings. They're designed to ensure that the child's welfare is at the centre of that decision-making and allows the support network provided by the children's hearing to be provided in these cases. But given that they were not moved last week, they will not also be withdrawn. So that would be 85, 86, 87 and 88, Convener.
OK, I'll ask you that through the formal proceedings, yep. Ms McCall, but thank you for giving us notice of that. Can I now ask Liam Kerr to speak to Amendment 206 and other amendments in the group?
I'm very grateful, Convener, and again, with the committee's indulgence, I shall speak to Amendment 206 in Russell Finlay's name, as he apologises he can't be with us today due to other committee business. Convener, victims must be heard. Too often, they say they are treated as bystanders in the criminal justice system. Now, recently, the Criminal Justice Committee heard powerful and moving accounts from six rape survivors. These women described, and I quote, being treated as a bit of evidence, not respected, treated with contempt, that I didn't matter, a feeling like collateral damage, the court environment being threatening, and that the justice system failed me more than the perpetrator. It was astonishing testimony. And these were all recent cases. Now, the Criminal Justice Scotland Act of 2003 gives victims of certain crimes the right to make a statement about the crime's impact to be submitted to court after a conviction and prior to sentencing to inform the judge or sheriff as they make their sentencing decision. Now, that has since been extended, with victim impact statements now commonplace. Now, as I set out last week, the more serious cases will be dealt with by the panel. And as I said, this will inevitably increase with the raised age limit. Now, one would think it obvious that a victim should be heard, regardless of whether they've been assaulted by an 18-year-old sent to a panel or someone who's older who is in court. And therefore, looking back, the arguments for victim impact statements as a principle have been accepted, have been made, and have been accepted. Victims must have their say, regardless of the forum. And this amendment ensures that their voices will be heard and important rights do not seem to be eroded.
Can I take an intervention?
Yes, I will.
Grateful for the intervention. I understand and share entirely the motivation behind it, but my question is whether this amendment creates duplication, because my understanding of the system as it currently stands is victims will already have the opportunity to make an impact assessment before the case is referred to the children's hearing system. So the hearing panel would already be in possession of that statement. But this, if I understand this amendment correctly, it would then essentially repeat that. And my concern there would be about the impact on victims having to recount their trauma repeatedly when they have already been given the opportunity to do so, and the panel should have possession of that.
I'm very grateful for the intervention. I don't think it does create that duplication, first of all, because it allows where the court has remitted the case following the conviction, but also it allows an element of the passage of time. Remember, what this amendment's doing is giving the opportunity to the victim to make a victim statement rather than imposing any obligation on the victim. So that choice will still be there, but I think it's a very important right to be given to the victim should they need to update any victim impact statement that's previously been given. Perhaps some post-traumatic incident has come out. The opportunity is being given by the amendment. So I'm grateful for the intervention, and I think I think that is answered by my response. And therefore, Convener, I move Amendment 206 in Russell Finlay's name.
Can I invite the Minister now to speak to Amendment 89 and other amendments in that group, please?
Thanks, Convener, and I thank Ms McCall for her explanation on those amendments. The remittal of a child's case to the hearing system provides the opportunity for them to be afforded more age and stage appropriate, welfare-based and holistic support to meet their needs. In the consultation on the bill, the majority of respondents supported further exploration of the proposal to enable all children under the age of 18 to be remitted from a court to the principal reporter. The rationale behind this was that this would lead to improved outcomes for children in recognition of the trauma, abuse and other adversities experienced by so many children that are in conflict with the law. Respondents also recognised that reform in this area would allow the rehabilitative potential of the children's hearing system to be maximised. Fundamentally, Amendments 85 to 88 would remove the ability to of 16 and 17-year-olds in solemn proceedings to have their case remitted to the PR to arrange for the disposal of the case by a children's hearing. But I understand Ms McCall is not moving those amendments. Turning to Russell Finlay's Amendment 206, I note that there are parallels with amendments debated last week that sought to take and have regard to views of the person affected by the child's offence or behaviour in the children's hearing system, and I note in particular Amendment 168 that was not supported in the vote of the committee. Amendment 206, I do not believe, is appropriate. The legislative framework for victim impact statements, which concerns the criminal justice system, provides that they can be made in certain courts and in relation to certain prescribed offences only, in cases where it would be possible for such a statement to be provided. As we have already heard, this might have already been received and considered by the court ahead of the case being remitted. This amendment does not specify which offences it intends to apply to. If it is all offences, it would go even wider than the existing measures in the criminal justice system. In addition, the purpose of victim impact statements is to inform sentencing, and as the committee is aware, remittal to the children's hearing system does not constitute a sentence, nor does the hearing impose a sentence. Yes.
Point. I absolutely understand what she's saying. I wonder, the children's hearing system being a welfare system, would restorative justice play a part in that, to understand the impact that actions had had on the other child who'd been harmed?
Yes, I would say so. And as I'm going to come on, there are already vehicles in the children's hearing system for victims, for the impact on a victim to be taken into consideration. Yes.
Thank you very much. I appreciate that. Just following up on that point, I accept again what she's saying about the amendment itself. And it may well be that it was a probing amendment and there's still further work to go. But the principle that's been established in terms of the current provisioning under the criminal justice system as compared to the new provisioning in very serious cases where we recognise there could be an uptick, particularly around rape and serious sexual assault. Is the minister willing to give further thought to how the voice of victims can be heard within the process, even whilst not accepting this amendment, because there clearly now is a marked difference from the opportunity for people, which is so important to make their voices heard, even more important, I would argue, than providing a written statement, because it's taking, for a victim, it's taking their place and literally having their voice heard. So will the minister give further consideration to that, even though I fully accept that the amendment itself may not be perfect in terms of the legislation?
I could certainly explore that. What I would say is that the impact of the child's behaviour on a victim is currently a consideration within the hearing system. However, a victim impact statement, as the member noted, the way the amendment is at the moment, the victim impact statement, I think, risks disproportionately influencing panel members' decision-making. And as we've already said, the central plank of the hearing system is that decisions are taken in the best interests of the referred child. However, I'd certainly be exploring that more. I think the focus of the consideration by the panel, I mean, I spoke last week about not turning hearings into a mini court setting. I think we have to be very careful about transforming the ethos of the hearing system. And I think the consideration of the panel must be through the lens of considering what compulsory measures are necessary to safeguard and promote the referred child's welfare. And in so doing, it concludes any measure necessary to prevent the child from causing further harm to others. And as I say, the impact of that behaviour can be on a victim can already be taken into consideration. In relation to Amendments 89 and 91, the Scottish...
intervene on that, because I won't get a chance to sum up, will I? So I offer an intervention.
Of course, Mr. Kerr.
Could the member, the minister, suggest that how she suggested that the amendment doesn't specify which cases it relates to, but how does that position hold up when, in fact, if we look at Section 15, it does specify it, arguably, because it's cases that are remitted pursuant to Section 15. I wonder if she can address that point. And also, can she address the time point that my colleague Ross Greer intervened on, and I responded, saying, well, look, actually there are matters that could arise in between the initial statement that she's talked about and any further statement. Could she address that point?
Sorry, Mr. Kerr, could you repeat your second point for me?
Yes, I can. Ross Greer intervened on me, and in my response to him, because I think it was a fair intervention, and he said, look, if there's already been a statement made at an earlier stage in the process, arguably you're asking people to relive the trauma. But I responded to him and said, well, actually, all that the amendment does is give the option to the victim. It allows the victim the option to make a further statement. And that point was not addressed in your remarks, and I wonder if you could say your thoughts on that.
My thoughts around that are really come back to the whole idea of the victim impact statement challenging the ethos of the hearing system. I really don't think I can be any further clearer on that. I believe.
Respect, because what I was saying was it gives the victim a further opportunity. It's not about the ethos, it's about offering a further opportunity. Why do you reject, Minister, the opportunity being afforded?
Because, as I said, the impact on a victim is already taken into consideration, and I believe that the option of a victim impact statement in the setting of a children's hearing system is not necessarily in keeping with the ethos of the hearing system. That's quite, I think I've been quite clear. In relation to what Mr. Kerr was asking around what the types of cases, it doesn't specify exactly what types of cases it is referring to. Intervention. Does.
Thank you very much, Minister. Much appreciated. I'm just wondering, you'd mentioned earlier on about disproportionately impacting panel members if there was a victim statement using their own voice there. And I'm just wondering, surely from the point of view as well, it would also be about the panel having the fullest information possible and the fullest understanding of all the facts in the whole matter in its entirety?
Absolutely. And as I've said multiple times, each referred child's case is different. And it would be for the panel to decide what information they required in order to inform their decision, and they would have appropriate avenues to gather that information from the various different services that are involved. I would just say, in terms of this further information in the children's hearing system, I mean, just last week the committee did agree that it wasn't appropriate to give further voice or to give that opportunity. So I'm just a little unclear as to why we're essentially we are debating this again when it has already been agreed that should not be the case.
With all due respect, Minister, I've already made reference to the fact that this is a committee debate, and I'm going to facilitate as much discussion and debate around this as possible. Okay, so can I move swiftly on to Ros McCall to wind up? Oh,
I've not finished
Minister.
On my amendments. That was just interventions. So, turning to Amendments 89 and 91, the Scottish Government is absolutely committed to tackling domestic abuse. And in approaching the bill, we've promoted ensuring that children in conflict with the law can access the age-appropriate hearing system where possible in line with children's rights. Now, the remittal framework in the bill covers specific instances where courts have levers not replicated in the hearing system, and we've listened to testimony during stage one from victims' organisations. The point has been made that enabling more 16 and 17-year-olds to access the hearing system may mean that at this age group are more likely to be in relationship, and of course that brings consideration into possible offending around domestic abuse. Now, the Lord Advocate's guidelines will, however, determine these cases which can be referred, and the Procurator Fiscal will obviously retain the discretion to prosecute. The joint referral framework and guidelines will be updated and published after this bill is passed, as they would be following any Act of Parliament. Amendments 89 and 91 will enable courts to be able to make a non-harassment order or NHO where the court is satisfied on a balance of probabilities that it is appropriate to do so to prevent a victim from harassment, or where the child has been convicted of an offence under domestic abuse legislation to protect the victim of that offence, and to thereafter be able to remit the case for disposal at a children's hearings if this is considered appropriate. So remittal in this case would not affect the non-harassment order, which will remain in place. And for example, breach of a non-harassment order would still be a criminal offence, which would be dealt with by the court. As the briefing to the committee from the Children and Young People Commissioner Scotland stated, our view is that this will ensure that the child receives the support they need to comply with the non-harassment order and will therefore strengthen protections for victims. On Amendment 90, the committee will be familiar with the bill's remittal framework concerning road traffic offences. Yes?
Just help me understand, Minister, because I'm just on this Amendment 91. So the court that initially puts a non-harassment in place has a victim impact statement to assist it. But because the government intends to vote down Amendment 206, the panel may not be able to avail itself of the same level of information. Am I reading that right, Minister?
As I've previously said, it will be up to the panel to determine what information they require to deal with an individual child's case, and that will be on a case-by-case basis.
Is that correct?
In terms of
a victim children impact who statement have been available in one forum and not the other?
Well, yes, but that is because of the differences in the settings. So, yes. Remittal in this case would not affect the... Yes.
Can I ask this point then, given that the Minister didn't support six of the amendments that I brought last week in this space, giving opportunity to ask victims for an opportunity to intervene in various different points, which were slightly narrowly focused in this amendment, where does the Minister intend victims to have their say and at what point?
As I've said very clearly, the impact of any act on the victim will be already taken into consideration by the panel, and and the decisions will be made by that panel on how they feel is best to approach. I can't be any clearer around the ethos of the children's hearing system and how it is not a mini court setting, and that a victim impact statement, going back to my previous response, could impact on the judgment based on what is right for the child who is at the centre of the children's hearing system. I'm sorry, convener, but I really don't understand how I can be any clearer than this. The victim will receive, and as we debated last week, there is increased support through this bill for the victim and for information to the victim. But we have to remember that in terms of the children's hearing system, it is the referred child that has to be at the centre of that, and decisions that are made to best impact on the child at the heart of the hearing.
There, Minister, I think the number of questions that are coming in this regard sort of gives an indication that the responses perhaps haven't been as clear as some of the committee members are seeking. Are you still carrying on to speak to your amendments, or is that?
Yes, I have a little left. Thank you.
Okay.
So. Remittal in this case would not affect the non-harassment order and it will remain in place. And, for example, a breach of a non-harassment order would still be a criminal offence, which would be dealt with by the court. On Amendment 90, the committee will be familiar with the bill's... Sorry, I repeated myself there. The committee will be familiar with the bill's remittal framework concerning road traffic offences. Driving disqualifications can occur when a person accumulates 12 or more penalty points on their licence within 3 years. The so-called totting up provision in Section 35 of the Road Traffic Offenders Act 1988. And this amendment extends the ability of the court so it's able to impose a totting up disqualification and still remit the case to the children's hearing for disposal if felt to be appropriate. So I would urge members not to press amendments 85, 86, 87, 88 and 206. And I would, if these are pressed, urge the committee not to support. I move amendment 89 and ask members to support the government amendments within this grouping.
Thank you. Now I invite Ros McCall to wind up, press or withdraw amendment 85, please.
Thank you. It's an interesting feeling to be winding up where the debate moved on in such a way. As I've already stated, I won't be moving mine, but I'm very concerned about the way that debate, the way the debate followed that process. And it's interesting to be summing up really on something that is an additional amendment, but I would urge, and I will be, if I was in that position, I would be supporting 206. But I'm concerned about that process, that victims, that disparity that's there, and that the ethos holds true to possibly a detrimental respect. But
would Ros McCall take an intervention?
I will.
Yes. Very briefly.
I'm very grateful, Convener, and I will be brief. Does she share with me the concern that we seem to have a tautology argument over the word victim statement as compared to what it should be, which is an understanding of the victim's experiences at the time that either panels or indeed courts are reaching a decision?
Yeah, and a quick answer is yes, I agree with that. But I will state that I'm not moving my First Amendment, which is 85.
So, Robert seeks to withdraw?
Correct.
Amendment 85. Does any member object? No, the amendment is therefore withdrawn. Our next question is that Amendment 86, in the name of Ros McCall, already debated with Amendment 85. Ros McCall to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 87, in the name of Ros McCall, already debated with Amendment 85. Ros McCall to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 88, in the name of Ros McCall, already debated with Amendment 85. Ros McCall to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 206, in the name of Russell Finlay, already debated with Amendment 85. Liam Kerr to move or not move?
I press that amendment.
Okay. The question is that Amendment 206 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 206? Okay. Those against? And those abstaining? The result of amendment of the vote on Amendment 206 is 4-4, against 5, with 1 abstention. Amendment 206 is therefore not agreed. I call Amendment 89 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 85. Minister to move formally.
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 89 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes. Yes. Okay. The question... Oops, sorry. The call Amendment 90 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 85. Are the Minister to move formally, please?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 90 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes. Thank you. I call Amendment 91 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 85. Minister to move formally?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 91 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes, we are. Thank you. So the next question is that Section 15 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes, thank you. Okay. I call Amendment 92 in the name of Ros McCall. Already debated with Amendment 11. Ros McCall to move or not move.
My apologies, 92. That's not moved.
Again, I call Amendment 93 in the name of Ros McCall. Already debated with Amendment 11. Ros McCall to move or not move.
Not moved.
I call Amendment 94 in the name of Ros McCall. Already debated with Amendment 11. Ros McCall to move or not move.
Not moved.
I call Amendment 95 in the name of Ros... Oh, so let me just say this is about detention in secure accommodation post 18. Okay. And I call Amendment 95 in the name of Ros McCall, group with Amendments 97, 103 and 104. Ros McCall to move Amendment 95 and speak to all amendments in the group, please. Ros McCall.
Thank you, Convener. Again, a section of probing amendments, hopefully to move forward for debate. I am aware that there's been council decisions over the past recent years to reduce their residential estate. And it begs the question of safeguarding. And I think safeguarding is very important. And ensuring that there is a prudent level of safeguarding within our residential placements. We could so easily have a situation where an over 18-year-old, by legal definition, an adult, is within a secure accommodation, as it's been deemed important that liberty is withdrawn. Living in the same secure accommodation with a child, i.e. somebody under the age of 18, where it's placed there for them to stay out of harm's way. So this is an unacceptable position, and giving the state of residential placements and residential estate across the country, I would be really interested if the Minister could outline the safeguarding measures within the bill and how she would ensure that this scenario just will not happen in reality. And And that's a general overfeeling of this section. It is to start debate and hopefully increase the debate on this. I'm not 100% sure that the safeguarding measures in place are sufficient, and I'd be very interested to hear what the Minister has to say on that, and that's prior to 95.
Thank you. Minister, can you respond to that, please?
Absolutely. So the provisions in sections 16 and 17 of the bill as introduced on enabling children detained in secure accommodation after turning to 18 to stay in that accommodation are necessary to keep the promise. The independent care review concluded if a young person turns 18 during their time in secure care, there must not be an automatic transfer to a young offenders institute. There must be scope to remain in secure care for those who have turned 18. And this change was also recommended by a previous Justice Committee of this Parliament. The amendments in this group are contrary to this. And while I appreciate these are probing amendments, I do find it disappointing given the shared commitment this Parliament has in terms of keeping the promise to people who have experience of Scotland's care system. Now, the approach in the bill as introduced supports stability, continuity of care and support and enduring relationships for children in secure care, as well as providing for gradual and improved transitions for children turning 18, which is crucial to support their reintegration and rehabilitation. I think these benefits would be lost if these amendments were pushed and agreed. The bill, as introduced, is consistent with the UNCRC and with international human rights standard by allowing case-by-case decision-making. So where consideration is being given to a child remaining in secure accommodation beyond the age of 18, that decision would be made on a case-by-case basis to ensure that the decision is in the best interests and not contrary to not just that child, but also the other children in that facility.
Yes.
Apologies if this has already been covered, but what consideration has been given thus far should a young man in secure accommodation elect to self-identify to a different gender? And I mean that specifically from a safeguarding perspective. has the detail of that been worked up? Because obviously this has been much discussed at the Justice Committee. Thank you.
Well, I'll touch on a lot of that throughout my comments, but what I would say is this is for secure care centres to deal with on a case-by-case basis. So I really couldn't sit here today and say how that specific instance would be dealt with. So discussions around this, I'll continue. And then if Ms Thompson would like to come back in, I'm more than happy for her to do so. Because the specific considerations will be detailed in the regulations and this will undergo parliamentary scrutiny and are subject to the affirmative procedure. If it's concluded that remaining in the secure accommodation will not be in the best interests of the young person themselves or in the best interests of any other child, the young person would not remain in that secure accommodation. So I hope that that alleviates any concerns that the committee and others outside Parliament might have regarding any potentially negative implications for the other children that are cared for within that care setting, within that secure accommodation setting. Now, although secure care centres do not currently support children over the age of 18, they are supportive of this change. And as I say, discussions are ongoing as to how this will be implemented. Secure centres are already working to prepare for implementation of this element of the bill if it's passed, and to ensure that the needs of all children and young people in their care can be met. And these provisions also received positive support in the public consultation on the bill proposals in 2023. There's no distinction on secure care that is based on gender, as I'll discuss later. And each centre has their own considerations on, as I say, each case and how that would be managed. So, as I say, these discussions are ongoing just now, and I'm sure if the member wishes further information on that, then that could come at a later date.
Very briefly. What's the consideration in the balance of young people who are not in secure accommodation but are identified as needing secure accommodation, as compared to those who've reached 18 and may need to stay in secure accommodation? What's the balance between, in essence, the push to get in and the need to stay in as they travail past their 18th birthday?
So you mean if there was an overcapacity problem?
Or an undercapacity problem?
That is not something that we have been met with in recent years. There has been capacity in the secure care centres. Again, that would be an issue that we would have to deal with at the time on a case-by-case basis in discussion with the secure care centres around that. And it would really be what's best for the children involved. So while I can imagine that, and I'm sure Mr Whitfield can as well, I probably couldn't lay that out in black and white here because, as I say, it wouldn't be a decision for me as a minister to take. Amendments 95, 97, 103 and 104, on the other hand, would remove the ability to allow children detained in secure accommodation before the age of 18 to remain there. So obviously this would mean that those young people would require to move to a YOI on their 18th birthday, regardless of their needs. And we do see that. We have seen that where children have been moved on their birthday, regardless of their needs, vulnerabilities or best interests, and regardless of how much or how little of their sentence remains to be served, which could just be a few days. And I'm sure the committee would agree that that would be a lot of upheaval for a young person to be transferred to a young offenders institution for simply a matter of days. For children detained under Sections 44 and 216 of the Criminal Procedure Act 95, there's actually no provision in law for these children to be detained in YOIs. Therefore, on turning 18, these children would either need to be released or would need to be moved to another place. And that would be chosen by the local authority, but not secure. So, as I say, Ms McCall's amendments will mean that young people detained in secure would be subject to a cliff edge. However, I appreciate that Ms McCall has said that, I believe she said that she doesn't intend to press them. If pressed, I would not be able to support them.
Thank you, Minister. Now, can I bring back Ros McCall to wind up, press or withdraw Amendment 95, please?
Convener, I was talking about a very specific scenario, which I'm really not 100% sure I actually got a sort of response for, and it is safeguarding. Whilst I understand that it will be on a case-by-case basis, and whilst I understand that would be for local authorities to decide, there has also got to be an absolute certainty that there is the financial and support provision there to be able to make sure that this happens. I'm not 100% convinced by the answer that we have got that fail-safe in place. As much as I understand the Young Offenders Institute position, and I have put forward some amendments that I think people will be concerned or even worried why I'm doing it in that direction, but there needs to be that an option, and it needs to be in place, and I'm really not sure that that's there. But I will not press these particular amendments, but I am still concerned and will look to discuss this with the Minister as to how this moves forward for Stage 3.
Okay, so Ros McCall seeks to withdraw Amendment number 95. Does any member object? No. Okay. My next question, the amendment is therefore withdrawn. My next question is that Section 16 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes. I call Amendment 96 in the name of Ros McCall, already debated with Amendment 11. Ros McCall, to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 97 in the name of Ros McCall, already debated with Amendment 95. To move, Ros McCall, to move or not move?
Again, not moved.
I call Amendment 98 in the name of Ros McCall, already debated with Amendment 11. Ros McCall, to move or not move? We're now moving on to the minor and technical grouping. And I call Amendment 99 in the name of the Minister, grouped with Amendments 101, 115, 116, 117 and 118. And Minister, to move Amendment 99 and speak to all amendments in the group, please.
Thank you, Convener. Once again, as you've noted, the amendments in this group are all minor and technical amendments. And while I am happy to explain any of them in detail if committee members wish, I am equally happy to move Amendment 99 and invite members to support it. And yes.
Convener, there may be technical amendments, but surely the Minister ought to put it on the record as to why these amendments are necessary and therefore being put forward, so that at least the committee can understand, but certainly anyone looking at the official record is able to understand in the future.
Of course, I'm happy to. So for those children who are detained under Section 205, which is punishment for murder, and Section 208 on conviction on indictment of the Criminal Procedure Scotland Act 95, the Scottish Ministers already have powers to direct the place and conditions of detention, although these powers will be subject to new Section 208A as inserted by Section 17 of the Bill, which provides that children may not be detained in a prison or a young offenders institution. In respect of Amendments 99 and 101, where a child is convicted and sentenced under solemn proceedings, then under Sections 205 and 208 of the Criminal Procedure Act, the Scottish Ministers direct where the child is to be detained. Under the provisions of the Bill, children under the age of 18 will no longer be placed in a young offenders institution in any circumstances, and as I've already noted, this change is essential for Scotland to keep the promise. Amendments 99 and 101 clarify that whilst the Scottish Ministers cannot direct that a person while a child be detained in a prison or young offenders institution, on turning 18, a person can be transferred from secure accommodation to a YOY should they not remain insecure until a maximum age of 19 and in due course to a prison. Amendment 116 clarifies the early release provisions that apply to certain children convicted on indictment and sentenced to detention under Section 208 of the Criminal Procedure Act 95. It amends Section 7 of the Prisoners and Criminal Proceedings Act 93. The amendment was of a technical nature rather than substantive. It ensures that children who are detained under Section 208 of the 95 Act will be subject to the same early release provisions if they are then sentenced, while so detained, to a determinate term of detention or imprisonment of 4 or more years, and by virtue of Section 27(5) of the 93 Act, such terms of detention or imprisonment are treated as a single term. Amendment 115 is consequential on paragraph 7.3 of the schedule of the bill, which amends section 245A of the Criminal Procedure Scotland Act 95 to enable a restriction of liberty order, or RLO, to be made in respect of any child under 18 rather than 16, as is currently the case. A local authority must provide supervision of and advice, guidance and assistance for a child during the period when a child is subject to an RLO. This amendment means that the relevant local authority must provide such support to any child under 18 who is subject to an RLO, as currently this duty only applies to children under 16. Amendment 117 is a consequential amendment and removes paragraph 12 from the schedule of the bill. This is no longer required because the change made by Amendment 116 removes the reference to remand centres, which paragraph 12 seeks to repeal. There are no such facilities in Scotland and no plans to reintroduce these. To do so would be inconsistent with the promise. Amendment 118 makes minor consequential amendments around local authorities' duties in relation to children detained under the Criminal Procedure Act 95. The amendments are in consequence of Part 2 of the Bill and are important to ensure there is effective oversight of the discharge of local authority duties to children who are detained via the different criminal justice routes. Such oversight is important given the particular needs, risks and vulnerabilities these children are likely to have experienced and the significant impact being detained has for these children and their rights. Local authorities have key duties towards these children, and the amendment to Section 5 of the Social Work Scotland Act 1968 ensures that Scottish ministers have powers to issue directions to local authorities, not just for those children and young people detained under Section 51 of the 95 Act while awaiting trial or sentence, but also for those children and young people detained in summary proceedings under Section 44 or detained for fine default under Section 216 of the 95 Act. This is an important change to ensure such directions can be provided consistently to cover all the criminal justice routes in terms of which a child may be detained. The amendment to the Public Services Reform Act 2010 removes an existing unnecessary definition of social work services due to other changes in the bill. The number of children subject to an RLO is relatively low at any one time, but from April 2022 to March 2023, there were 43 new RLOs for under-18s. None of these were for children under the age of 16, and 83% of the orders made were for those aged 17 years old at the order start date, with only 17% aged 16 on the order start date. Whilst this might have some financial implications for local authorities, given the small numbers of children being made subject to those orders, it's likely to be minimal. It's noted that owing to other changes in the bill, the demand placed by children on justice social work is likely to reduce, but owing to the funding structures of justice social work, no transfer of these savings is possible at this time. I move Amendment 99 and invite members to support this amendment and all other amendments within the grouping.
Thank you, Minister. So the question is that Amendment 99 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes, we are agreed. I call Amendment 101. No, it's not. I call Amendment 100 in the name of Ros McCall, already debated with Amendment 11. Ros McCall to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 101 in the name of the Minister, already debated with Amendment 99. The Minister to move formally?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 101 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes, we are all agreed. I call Amendment 102 in the name of Ros McCall, already debated with Amendment 11. Ros McCall to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 103 in the name of Ros McCall, already debated with Amendment 95. Ros McCall to move or not move?
Not moved.
I call Amendment 104 in the name of Ros McCall, already debated with Amendment 95. Ros McCall to move or not move?
Not moved, convener.
Sorry. The next question is that Section 17 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Okay. So we're now going to move on to the next section, measures for children who have committed an offence. And I call Amendment 105 in the name of the Minister, grouped with Amendments 207, 208 and 209. Minister, to move Amendment 105 and speak to all amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. Government Amendment 105 aims to ensure that children and young people with a mental disorder who are convicted on indictment and sentenced to detention are provided with the most appropriate level of care and treatment at the right time. So currently, while a court can make a hospital direction in respect of some 16 and 17-year-olds, those who are not subject to a compulsory supervision order, a court cannot make a hospital direction in respect of a child under the age of 16 or those aged between 16 and 18 years old who are subject to a CSO. So the Scottish Government considers that this should be addressed, given the clear benefits for the child of being able to go straight to hospital for mental health care and treatment, as opposed to the child transferring to a hospital from another setting of detention. Hospital directions are very rarely used for 16 and 17-year-olds. However, ensuring that they may be applied for in exceptional defined circumstances for children is both desirable and necessary. The inception of specialised facilities at Foxgrove, the first medium secure national secure adolescent inpatient service in Scotland, changes the backdrop of how the complex mental health needs of children and young people are met in Scotland. The opening of Foxgrove this year will mean that there will be age-appropriate forensic mental health provision for adolescents in Scotland, including those who are subject to hospital directions. Amendment 105 makes no change to the nature of hospital directions or the conditions which must be satisfied for them to be applied, other than making them available to all children aged 12 to 17 with a mental disorder who are convicted on indictment and sentenced to detention. Turning to Martin Whitfield's amendments, and whilst I understand the intention behind the amendments, I would not support them in this instance. Amendment 207 would place a duty on Scottish ministers to promote the use of alternatives to the detention of children convicted of an offence and to report annually on the steps taken to achieve this. Now, it's not entirely clear whether this is a general duty to promote alternatives to detention or whether Mr Whitfield wants ministers to promote alternatives in specific cases of individual children who have been convicted of an offence. If the amendment is intended to be general, which we would assume it is, then there's already provision in this regard. If the amendment is intended to be specific to an individual case, this would undermine the independence of the judiciary, and I'm sure Mr Whitfield doesn't intend that. Except in respect of punishment for murder, the decision to deprive a child of their liberty on conviction is an independent decision of the courts, and in doing so, the court is required to comply with ECHR. For those children convicted on indictment under Section 208 of the 95 Act, there is a presumption against detention, ensuring that the court can only impose a period of detention if it considers that no other method of dealing with that individual is appropriate. For those children convicted summarily under Section 44 of the 95 Act, the court may order that the child be detained in residential accommodation for a period not exceeding 1 year. A presumption against detention is set out in guidance, including that published by Scottish ministers, and this is in line with the UNCRC, which says that deprivation of a child's liberty should be the option of last resort and for the shortest appropriate period of time. Indeed, the use of alternatives to deprivation of liberty for children is a cornerstone of the Scottish Government's whole system approach, in which the use of alternatives to detention are already promoted. In practice, local authorities have a range of alternatives available to depriving a child of their liberty, which they can put to the court as options instead of detention. The Scottish Government's vision for youth justice and standards for those working with children in conflict with the law, both published in 2011, represent a shared foundation between the Scottish Government and partners to continue to support an approach which keeps children out of the criminal justice system and promotes the use of alternatives to detention. Data on the use of alternatives to detention for under-21s is currently published annually in the Criminal Proceedings in Scotland, which is published on the Scottish Government's website. In relation to Amendment 208, restorative justice is a voluntary, supported process of contact between someone who has been harmed and the person who has caused that harm, and both parties can withdraw consent at any time. Section 5 of the Victims and Witnesses Scotland Act 2014 already gives the Scottish ministers powers to issue guidance about the provision of restorative justice services. Such guidance aimed at service providers and facilitators was published in 2017 and outlines the key principles of restorative justice. To ensure that restorative justice processes are available, these are delivered in a coherent and consistent and victim-focused manner across Scotland. This includes where children are the victims or the alleged perpetrator. In addition, the Restorative Justice Prescribed Persons Scotland Order 21 was made under the 2014 Act and provides a list of prescribed persons who must have regard to this guidance. The list of persons includes the Scottish ministers, a local authority, and persons who provide restorative justice services. The Scottish Government is committed to ensuring that restorative justice services are available across Scotland, where the needs of persons harmed and their voices are central to that process. The services must be available at a time that is appropriate to the people and case involved. It must be consistent, evidence-led, trauma-informed and of a high standard. The Scottish Government has been working in partnership with Community Justice Scotland and the Children and Young People's Commission, the Children and Young People's Centre for Justice in order to deliver on this commitment. Information about restorative justice and the work being undertaken to achieve this vision is published on the Community Justice Scotland website, which provides a means of reporting. The Scottish Government also committed to explore or consult on the recommendations in respect of restorative justice in the Children's Hearings Report. Turning to Amendment 209, measures within the bill already do aim to enhance the rehabilitation and reintegration of children by ensuring that they can access age and stage appropriate welfare-based systems, supports and services when required, namely the children's hearing system and secure accommodation, as well as enhancing the safeguards available to children who need to go through the criminal justice system, including in respect of reporting restrictions. Section 21 of the bill includes provisions to ensure that those detained in secure accommodation are treated as looked after for the purposes of Sections 29, 30 and 31 of the Children's Scotland Act 95. This includes aftercare up to the age of 19 and 26 in certain circumstances to aid a child's transition to adulthood. As detailed in the policy memorandum for the bill, the Sentencing Young People's Guideline stated that rehabilitation is a primary consideration when sentencing a young person. And this is in line with Article 40 of the UNCRC, which provides that all children under 18 who have been accused of committing a crime have the right to be treated in a manner consistent with the promotion of the child's sense of dignity and worth, which reinforces the child's respect for the human rights and fundamental freedoms of others, and which takes into account the child's age and the desirability of promoting the child's reintegration and assuming a constructive role back into society. The rehabilitation and reintegration of children who have committed an offence is already a key tenet of the Scottish Government's whole system approach to preventing offending by children and young people. A package of support should be detailed in a child's plan to help them successfully integrate back into their community, and this is incorporated in the standards for those working with children in conflict with the law. Adding a duty for the Scottish ministers to report on something which is led by local authorities does not appear to fit with the role of Scottish ministers. So in summary, I move Amendment 105, but I cannot support the other amendments in this group and ask members not to press them.
Thank you, Minister. Can I now ask Martin Whitfield to speak to Amendment 207 and the other amendments in the group, please?
I'm very grateful, Convener, and I'm conscious of time on the committee, so I'll try and make this as short as possible, because the purposes behind these amendments in some cases have been addressed by the Minister, so it may actually simply be a case, if the Minister's open to this, to responding to questions rather than submission last time, and it may facilitate my ability or decision on whether I push or not. With regard to firstly, can I welcome the government's amendment in respect of this? But if I look at my amendment 207, which is the alternative to detention of children, the Minister was right that this was a generic requirement rather than a requirement specific to any individual act, which would be completely inappropriate given the nature of assessing from the individual's point of view. Firstly, is the Minister confident, or is the Minister certain that the reporting provisions that she has already outlined, plus the requirements within the UNCRC, mean that this information will be available on an annual basis to the public, albeit that rather than coming specifically from a Scottish minister, it may lay in a variety of places? I don't know whether you want to... I'm very grateful for that. That's very helpful. And again, if we move to restorative justice for children, of course, restorative justice can only work when all parties are open to it and maintain openness towards that approach as they go through the system. And I think one of the challenges that we've seen in restorative justice in other environments is where there's a misunderstanding as to what the restorative justice is, but more appropriately, perhaps a misunderstanding amongst those that surround the individuals who take part in restorative justice rather than... And again, the Minister was right to make mention of the 2017 publication. Is there an intention to revisit, to review and indeed republish that guidance under the provisions that we've already have already been by this committee amended into the next bit of the Act, but also to take it forward?
So, subsequent to the publication of the guidance, the 2017, provision of restorative justice services across Scotland was, I think, inconsistent and in some places potentially non-existent. And therefore, the Scottish Government subsequently published the Restorative Justice Action Plan, which sets out a further vision that restorative justice would be available across Scotland. Now, this has been slightly delayed, as I understand it. It was I believe the services were hoped to be available by 2023. However, work to date has, I mean, there's been some great complexities revealed in sort of implementing this, and coupled with the impact of the pandemic that's held up delivery. However, the commitment to establishing restorative justice services across Scotland remains. I think, as I say, there's been some complexities thrown up and we need to consider how we get that right. But absolutely, the commitment remains, and I'm more than happy to discuss that further or update the member on where we are with that.
I'm very grateful. Let me rephrase the question then. Would it be the best intentions of the Scottish Government to review and republish what starts as the 2017 guidance as soon as possible, given the important nature of restorative justice, not just within this bill, but in a wider context across Scotland? Is the Scottish Government happy to give best endeavours to achieve that?
Yes, absolutely. I mean, we've been committed to exploring and consulting on this further. And as I said, this is something that we looked at in relation to the Children's Hearings Redesign Report as well.
I'm very grateful. And that brings me to the last amendment that's in my name, 209, which is the rehabilitation and reintegration of children who have been guilty of offences. And this, I think, is very important, and I'm very grateful to the contributions that the Minister has made, because it is right that the rehabilitation and reintegration is a paramount part of how our young people can reintegrate into the communities. And we've heard in a number of amendments that have been put forward today and indeed last week that sits at the heart of what we're trying to achieve here. So, again, really with regard... in this case, to the reporting principles of it. Is the Minister absolutely confident that there will be sources of reporting, not necessarily through the government, but available to the public that can measure the success of both rehabilitation but also reintegration of young people at the end of their period of involvement?
I am confident. And given the extra attention to this in terms of whole system approach, I am confident. However, going forward, if that became something I was not confident about, I would certainly be looking to take action in that front, or look to what could be done.
I'm very grateful for those assertions. Thank you.
Martin Whitfield. Now, Minister, you've had quite a good discussion between yourselves there, but I'll call you to wind up this group now, please.
Nothing further to say. Formally moved.
That's helpful, Minister. The question is that Amendment 105 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes, we are agreed. I call Amendment 108 in the name of Ros McCall. Already... What did I say? 108. Oh, that's my... Literally, I need to get my line. My eyes are tired. I call Amendment 106. Apologies to the people that are taking notes of this. 106, in the name of Ros McCall, already debated with Amendment 11. Ros McCall, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Thank you, Ms McCall. The question is the amendment... No, it's not. Call Amendment 107 in the name of Ros McCall, already debated with Amendment 11. Ros McCall, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Thank you. So, look at that, 12:59 and 41 seconds. The question is that sections 18 to 21 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes. William? All right, thank goodness. So did I. Minor panic. Okay, so that concludes our consideration of the bill at stage two today, and the committee will continue its consideration at its meeting on the 7th of February. Thank you all for your time. I now close the meeting. And can I just... You've closed the meeting?